Meeting, please. Thank you. Welcome to the May 8th, 2007 School Board Meeting. Would you join me in the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Adjustments to the agenda. Alan?
Yes, one adjustment that I would like to make, and make it as 11A, is a discussion and possible vote on turf field and concession stand for the turf field.
So just the next letters, just change those all in succession?
Just move them down from there, so it'd be 11A.
Okay.
The second piece that I will do is should go into the superintendent's report, and that will go with my discussion about grant proposal procedures, and that will be talking about the Pond Cove grant for you. And I think those are the only changes that I have.
Okay. Anybody else have any changes? No? Okay. Approval of the March School Board minutes.
I move that we approve the minutes of the April 10th School Board meeting as presented.
Thank you, Trish. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Linda. Any discussion? All those in favor? 5-0. Thank you. Comments by high school, middle school, and Pond Cove students.
I should mention before you do start, the Pond Cove student is in a, is it a ball game at this point?
Yeah,
so he probably won't get here until about 8 o'clock. So we can do the high school and the middle school students, and then we'll pick him up when he comes in.
Okay, great. Well, why don't we start with high school? Is Daly and Rosie here?
Okay, well, recently, on Saturday, the juniors took the SATs. It was something that happened to all juniors in the state. And the few people I've talked to said that they were pretty prepared for it, so that was good. And then the AP testing also started this week, and I think that the stats test was today. And I know that the history one is on Friday, but I'm not sure about the other ones. And I know that they were long, but kids seemed pretty confident going into it. So. And then last night there was a drug and alcohol abuse presentation given in the cafeteria in the middle school. And a woman from Minnesota came and gave a presentation kind of, it was more directed towards parents, but about, there was probably more than half of the audience was kids, but the presentation was kind of about what parents should do, kind of the warning signs and at the end, there was an open floor for questions for Mr. Shedd, our principal, a police officer, Ms. Lisa, our guidance counselor, and Ms. Kay, our health teacher. And parents were allowed to ask questions, and I think that people found it really helpful and informative for the parents. So, that was good.
Okay, let's see. Prom is coming up this weekend. There's also a lot of activities that the seniors have planned. We have we're on a rafting trip as a class, and there's senior celebration, which is a night that's supposed to celebrate all seniors. And then there's a awards night and senior picnic, and there's a bunch of cool things coming up. There's a dance canceled that students were pretty unhappy about, and I don't know any student who thought that was a good thing for the school community to cancel that dance. That was in the wake of the tragedy of Rich and McCarthy's death, and that was a big event for the school communities. Well, yeah, obviously. There's also, I didn't have a chance to make it to the forum meeting, but my understanding was that there wasn't much much to talk about this time around, but we're gonna, a big thing we talked about in forum has been the student representative to the school board, and we're gonna get started up on that election. We're gonna have an assembly on Thursday, I think, or that's our goal, and I think that's about it. Yeah. Okay, and seniors brought their dogs into school, but they were sent home. Don't worry, it's not like that was just some senior fun. They caused some mayhem. Any questions?
Did they take the SATs?
Probably do better than us. Just kidding.
Any questions or comments from the board? Oh, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Middle school. Will? Michaela? Just Will?
Just Will.
Just Will. Okay.
Recently, we had our last school run dance, and I think that went off very well, and most of the people I talked to who participated enjoyed it thoroughly. As well as that, we just ended the Pennies for Patients campaign for leukemia research drive. And I'm not sure exactly how much we raised, but I do know that it was a substantial amount. Also, in the eighth grade, most or all of the students will be writing a letter to themselves, which they'll be opening senior year of high school. I think that's really cool, and a lot of kids are excited about that, actually. The student council now has enough money to donate a scholarship for $500 to a high school student, and we do that every year. And so that's, I think that's good. Also, the student council has given $200 to the recycling group run at in the middle school run by Senor Dana. And with that, they're going to purchase Nalgene bottles that they can sell at the school store. And we'll hope to reduce the amount of plastic bottles that kids purchase at school. And lastly, I have something about the Arts Night. It's on May 31st. It's coming at the middle school from 6:30 to 8, and it's going to be students and staff of the middle school. There's going to be live music, art, sixth grade film festival, an art bazaar, an art raffle, and as well as food. Come see the unveiling of our permanent art collection, our fifth grade ornamental designs in clay and copper, sixth grade film festival, seventh grade camp cave murals, and eighth grade sculpture garden. We'll also be raffling off a framed pastel by our art teacher, Marguerite Lala Roner. All proceeds will go to our visiting artist program. We want to continue working with nationally renowned sculptor Clara Cohn. Our goal is to create a student-designed sculpture garden in the interior courtyard and exterior entranceway to the school. We envision a three-year ongoing project that will reflect the active learning which takes place in the middle school. The courtyard project started this year with the support of the Maine Art Commission through the PAL grant. We hope that you will attend the Art Night and help us in our endeavors. So I'd just like to show everyone that the painting that Mr. Roner has graciously donated.
Wow.
Will, what is the medium? Is it oil or is it pastel?
It's pastel.
It's pastel.
So, Will, any questions?
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Will. Kelsey is here to give a report. Okay. Kelsey, are you here to give a report for the middle school?
No.
Okay.
Just I'll be calling her.
Okay.
Thank you. I guess moving on to recognition, Trish?
I just wanted to express publicly our thanks and gratitude for all the work that Patty McCarthy did on The View, the newspaper. I think it's made it into all the households, and it will be hand-delivered to the schools tomorrow or Thursday. She went above and beyond. She's the editor, and it just looks terrific. So we just wanted to thank her and recognize her for all of her hard work.
Thank you, Trish. Teacher Appreciation Week. We are currently at Teacher Appreciation Week, and Alan has provided me a poem to read, and it's a short poem. So, if you'll indulge me, it says, what is a teacher? A teacher is someone who sees each child as a unique person and encourages individual talents and strengths. A teacher looks beyond each child's face and sees inside their souls. A teacher is someone with a special touch and a ready smile who takes the time to listen to both sides and always tries to be fair. A teacher has a caring heart that respects and understands. A teacher is someone who can look past disruption and rebellion and recognize hurt and pain. A teacher teaches the entire child and helps to build confidence and raise self-esteem. A teacher makes a difference in each child's life and affects each family and the future of us all. By Barbara Cage. Thank you. Trish.
That was a great segue.
Thank you.
We have wonderful teachers in our community, and I wanted to recognize or at least thank the parents' associations for the terrific luncheons they provided for the teachers last week, and the door decorating and the signs of appreciation. There were probably, I would say, at least 50 parents who sort of spearheaded that effort. So I wanted to thank them for the time that they took. It was a good representation for all of us, and a wonderful way to thank our teachers for all that they do every day.
Thank you, Trish. Alan, Art and Music Week at the middle school and high school.
One of the things we're doing this week is to take a look at particularly the music that occurs from our buildings. We often talk about teachers teaching to have a result that is clearly shown. Our music people do that clearly. If you've been attending concerts over the years, it's always amazing to watch first when you go to Pine Cove and see the beginnings of it, go to the middle school and watch the difference between fifth grade and eighth grade performers, and then you go to the high school and you see the difference from 9 to 12. And it's always a great joy. Unfortunately, I don't make them all. I try very hard, but I try to get to as many as possible, and they're just unbelievable. So one of the things that the board talked about with me the other day is that we really take a look at the music programs this time and talk about them. So I have several different pieces to go with this. And I'm going to start with something that I received about the Pond Cove music program under Judy. And what it says is the music at Pond Cove. These are some of the highlights of music at the Pond Cove School. Our students learn that music and songs are another way to understand, experience, and view the world. We have grade level performances that include music about a variety of appropriate things, including seasons and integrated topics, varied styles, and cultures of dancing and instrumental music. Music helped ease the evacuation day in November, and I can speak to that. They were out to the Catholic Church. The music was amazing. Judy was right there with the keyboard, and the kids were just thoroughly enjoying it, and it really took away from some of the other things that were going on that day. Students sing, dance in folk dances, square dances, line dances, and even pop dances like swing and macarena. First graders attend the spring performance of the Main State Ballet. This year, it was Alice in Wonderland. Second graders traditionally attend the PSO and study Beethoven and perform in the Rainforest Concert. Third graders attend the PSO's Le Vent du Nord, pretty close, right? French and music join hands to enhance the students' experience. In recent years, they have attended Boston Lyric Opera's performance of the Magic Flute, and Daughter of the Regiment hosted locally. They perform square dancing and sing in either French or Spanish. The fourth graders attend the Barber of Seville recently, performed by the Boston Lyric Opera Company. They have enjoyed a jazz unit in February and March. We listened to and talked about Duke Ellington and George Gershwin. We swing dance. They sing in Spanish this year and perform on multicultural instruments. I would like to express from myself and for the board, Judy, the wonderful job that you're doing down there to get things going in those first years in Pond Cove, because that grows from there into whatever we do. So thank you very much. And then we go to the middle school. And what happened with the middle school is there are some students who have written some things. I know Kelsey is here to do hers, and I also have some from the other students that I don't think could be here tonight. And so we'll take care of those afterwards. But Kelsey, do you want to come up? And read your statement at this point. Statement, that's not a very good word. The essay you wrote. Thank you.
Well, my name is Kelsey McGuire, and I'm an eighth grader at Cape Elizabeth Middle School. And I play in both the school band and the jazz combo. And my experience with Mr. White has been a great one. I love to play music, and I got involved with the jazz program in seventh grade. And I knew it would be a really fun experience because I loved music, but I also knew that Mr. White would be teaching it, and he was an excellent teacher. And because of my experience with Mr. White in the middle school, both of my younger siblings are either in the program or plan to be in the program. My brother's in sixth grade, and he's a trumpet in the band, and my sister, who's in fourth grade, has high expectations to play in the fifth grade band. And Mr. White has a really great personality, and he helps us to improve all our skills while keeping it fun to play an instrument. And he also has a creative way for us to learn our scales and fundamentals of playing an instrument. We have competitions between the classes or sections to see who can complete the scales or tasks first, and this helps us learn the new rhythms or scales while having fun at the same time. And he also puts a great deal of time into choosing the pieces that the band plays, making sure that they aren't easy or hard, but at least challenging for the band so they can improve their playing. And he's at school like every morning for the jazz band, and he puts a lot of effort and is really supportive of us in that program. And I think he's a really great teacher, and because of him, I've chosen to continue music through high school. And he really inspires all of the middle school students that play with him.
Thank you very much. I have three others about Mr. White. Sarah Cummings is not here, am I correct? Okay. What she has written is, as an eighth grader who has spent all four middle school years in band, I have learned a lot from Mr. White. I started in fifth grade as a tiny trumpet player who could barely make a sound, yet now I'm a confident French horn player. And that has been a member of Southern Maine Middle School Honors Band for both my seventh and eighth grade years. Like a majority of students here at Cape Elizabeth Middle School, I don't take any private French horn lessons, yet I've learned so much and I'm very comfortable playing almost any new band piece Mr. White gives us. In fact, I've been so inspired that I will be going into the music camp this summer, where I'll be playing piano, my main instrument, as well as a bit of French horn. When I watch the fifth and sixth grade bands perform, it amazes me how much we've learned. In fifth grade, just playing whole notes as an entire band for the first time was such an accomplishment. Now, as a result of Mr. White's effort, one eighth grade band was able to play Festivo. Is that the one you did the other night? Yeah, it was tremendous. A huge challenge that ended up as a great success. And I added the word great to that. While I have spent my school years learning so much in regular band, I have spent one morning a week these past 2 years playing piano in the jazz band. Considering the fact that very few of us knew anything about jazz band before we started a year and a half ago, our band's accomplishments are very impressive. We've learned basic blues form, played in many different styles, and most importantly, learned how to improvise and play as a group. For many students here at Cape Elizabeth Middle School, jazz band is a highlight of their experience, for it's informational as well as lots of fun. And all of this can be accredited to Mr. White. Anyone who saw any of the concerts this past week would appreciate the amount of time and effort Mr. White puts into us. He's done so much for all of us, and I definitely think he deserves recognition. And I have to speak the same way. I was at those concerts and did a wonderful job. So congratulations. Another one is from Reed Duty. The amount of confidence, musical sense, and character I've acquired from my studies with Mr. White is astonishing. He taught us not to just play the notes given to us on a sheet of paper, but to use our heart into each and every line. I remember when our class played our first tune called Balloon Ride, and with our musical experience, it probably sounded like a cat clawing at a blackboard. I could only imagine the pain Mr. White was going through, but he still magnificently guided us through our musical journey. I was, and still am, ecstatic that I had the opportunity to play in this famous program. I have noticed from friends and family who have come to my grade performances, comment on the talent and finesse of our band. They have all been in awe of our music and often forgot that a middle school band is playing. All these comments should not be directed at our band, but to the man who really deserves the credit. This is a man who has been with us through the good and the bads. This man is my band teacher, Mr. White. Congratulations. And my last one is from Jack, and I don't think Jack is here either. I think all three of them were tied up tonight. Not literally, but figuratively. Throughout the past 4 years, Mr. White has taken the current eighth grade band to a level we had never thought of reaching. The eighth grade band has had a great run with Mr. White, and we are sad to say that he won't be our director anymore. From Balloon Ride to Festivo, we have played a variety of easy and challenging songs. And without Mr. White, I don't think that we could have made it as far as we did. We know that you have put plenty of time and effort teaching us, and we are thankful for everything you have done. Along with conducting the concert band, you have helped some of the band members become extremely amateur jazz musicians. You have sacrificed 30 minutes of your mornings to the Tuesday jazz band and the Thursday combo. You have prepared us very well for the years to come, and I think all of us will stay in jazz thanks to your great early training. I believe I can speak for everyone in the band when I say you have brought out the best in us. Thank you, Mr. White, for a great 4 years. And so, based on those, I want to congratulate you, Terry, on some wonderful work. Mrs. Bean. I have one letter that was written by three people who wanted to express their appreciation. And I don't think Miranda, Sarah, or Lexi are here. Am I correct? I don't want to read for them for now. Mrs. Bean is the most outgoing and positive teacher we've had in our 4 years of middle school. She always comes to class with creative and new ideas that benefit the classes in a positive way. Since we were in fifth, we have gotten to see her grow as a teacher as well as ourselves. And we can't think of music without the person who taught and strengthened our voices. Thank you, Mrs. Bean, for teaching us different types of music, listening to our ideas, and working with us so everyone is happy. We'll miss you. And that is by Miranda Hansen, Sarah Cummings, and Lexi Weatherby. Congratulations. And I think, Mr. Shade, are you going to introduce the both Ellers here?
They are.
These are Lauren and Rosemary Ehlers, who are both seniors at the high school, and I think they want to speak to the music program as well. So if you can come on up, girls.
Well, before we start, I'd just like to say that Mr. Schlesot's an amazing person, and I've been in his band for 4 years, and we've both played French horn. So Rosemary and I were asked to help recognize Mr. Schlesot tonight, and we were very honored to do so. And I was thinking about what I wanted to say, and I thought about how much I respect and admire Mr. Schlesot, and I realized that I shouldn't be saying this just for a special occasion, but every day. So I'd like to apologize for not letting you know every day how much I really respect and admire you. I speak for my sister and myself, and I think for any senior who knows you, when I say we'll miss you immensely, especially because it is impossible for any band director to step into your shoes. You're like that spectacular act at a variety show that leaves the audience breathless and feeling sorry for whoever had the bad luck to come after you. No one can best you. I will always remember your enthusiasm and passion for music and life, and it will be an inspiration to me throughout my life. I think everyone could use a little bit of Tom Lazat in their lives. I mean, what's more uplifting than Mitchell's out at 7:30 in the morning, yelling, "Happy Monday." I think one thing you always tried to teach was the importance of doing something you love, that being successful isn't about money. Someone is successful because they're happy to be doing what they're doing, happy to be where they are, happy to be with the people in their life, just happy to be alive and make the most of it. I actually don't know if that's exactly what you're trying to teach us, but intentional or unintentional, that's what I learned, and I think it's very true. And from what I've seen, I think you are maybe the most successful person I know. And Rosemary's going to finish the rest.
You're unlike many teachers in that you're also a friend. Whenever a note is sent home, parents immediately wonder, is my child in trouble? And maybe that's because most notes are not good notes. But a while ago, you sent a letter to our parents, and it was a wonderful note letting our parents know how well my sister and I were doing and how happy you were to have us in band and how good it was to have us as Finchhorn players. And that's what's really wonderful about you. You know even the shyest people in your band. Both of us always try to play the best in band. One reason, of course, is because we love to play, but it's also very inspiring when, since you first yelled and have continued to yell, yeah, horns! And we've drummed excitedly as if you could pull the sound out of our bells. I know, and I have to say, that's, I've never seen a teacher who yells excitedly and leaps around the room because they're so happy at something that their student has done. And I think that's something teachers could learn from you. Makes school a lot more interesting. where was I? Yes, I know most people yelling at someone and telling them to play louder doesn't usually sound like a compliment, but to my sister and I, it did. It means you wanted to hear us, and we did exactly what you said. We played so loud, we cracked our notes, and you'd still tell us to play louder. There's no satisfying some people. But we promise to play loud enough in college that you'll be able to hear us from New York, right?
New York,
yeah. New York and the West Coast. So, yeah. Also, your praise is seldom given, but when it is, it's given with such sincerity that it is taken to heart and never really forgotten. Just a few words in passing or after a concert go a long way, especially since there are so many people and instruments to listen to. I hope that we've given a little bit of that praise back now to someone who deserves it much more than we do. So once again, we'll miss you, Ms. Lazat, and thanks for everything. You're an amazing person.
Thank you.
What we had hoped to do this evening was to have Kristen bring some of her chorus, but when we found out SATs were Saturday, and they were therefore not in school on Monday, that became a problem for her to do that at this point in time. So I had an opportunity to talk to a couple of the choral members and to talk with them about what they have been doing with Kristen. First, you need to know that I've known Kristen because she taught for me in another district where I was superintendent before she came here. And what I've seen with Kristen over time, and I don't know if any of the choral people did come or not. No? Can I have you come up in just a minute? But what I have heard very strongly from each of them is the inspiration you give to them to sing. And it always thrills me, with any of you music people, when you're up on stage, but I watch Kristen in particular, when they're up there working with the students to perform, it is just amazing the attention they give and that look of great respect because what we have learned to do well. I see that very clearly with Kristen. I see it very clearly with each of you, but it really stands out for me perhaps because I've known Kristen for so long and see how that goes. And so I congratulate Kristen for what she's done. And we do have somebody to speak also. Thank you very much.
I didn't prepare anything. That's okay. I wasn't planning on this. But I've been with Kristen for one full year, and this year, I did not have the time in my schedule, the space to be in chorus, but I have been going during a free period. And she's really amazing. She's always cheerful, always very bouncy and ready to help. We've been trying to organize some singers for graduation and senior celebration, and she's always come to us with suggestions and time, much of her time. And she always has good music for the concerts, and she's always open to ideas for concerts. You might have noticed we sang Sister Act twice last year and this year, which everyone was very happy to do. And sometimes it seems like we're not going to get a song going, but we always seem to manage to get it ready for the concert. And I think that's about it. She's really fun to work with, So thank you for being here.
Thank you very much. And so to all five of you in the music department, first grade through 12th grade, my sincere thanks to you for all you do. You do push the performances out to the public. You are truly demonstrating the learning that is taking place. So thank you very much, and thank you for coming tonight also. I know how hard it is for you, let alone students who have 101 different needs that they have to meet too, so I really appreciate the time and effort you took. Thank you very much. Certainly.
I just wanted to add to all the wonderful words that were said that I think the music program, choral and music, is a paradigm for our district. It's a model that should be used throughout because you, all of you, work so well together. It's an incredible example of what cooperation, communication, collaboration can do. It's a true recipe for success, and I'd like to see it emulated throughout in other of our programs. So thank you.
You want to go on?
Yep.
The next piece I have is fifth grade Boston Museum of Science trip organizers. I want to comment on this for just a minute. We are really trying to do a lot as far as recognition of people who are doing great things in our school system, both students and adults. And it has come now that people do email us, and thank you very much, that people do email us and send us information. And so I received this message the other day from Kathy Walsh, who teaches at the middle school. And what she said is that there are two things she wanted to talk about. One is Matt Whaley, Carrie Newton, and Adam Killen. And she comments on their courage and determination to make the Boston Science Museum field trip the huge success that it was. Again, supported financially by the Parents Association, but hopefully it will be the beginning of a new and valuable tradition at the fifth grade. It is always nice to hear a teacher talking about this fellow teachers and what they do. And she also mentioned in this that certainly the efforts of Ruby Hawk with the support of Andy and her family to raise $2,145 for the Heart Association should also be noted. And of course, as many of you know from my perspective, I particularly appreciate that since I've had some interesting experiences with the Heart Association recently. But again, it is nice to get this information. The next one is the National Science Bowl team, and I think, Jeff, you're going to introduce them.
Three years ago, when Sean Garrett joined our science department, we didn't have any extracurricular science activities, and now he's at a rate where he's adding about one a year. I'm thinking that he's probably tapped out at this point. So it's actually not just Science Bowl, but there's a couple of other activities that students are going to be speaking to as well, and that is the North Shore Science League and the Science Olympiad. So I want to introduce, and they'll probably explain to you which events different people are involved in. The members of the Science Bowl and representatives of the North Shore Science League and the Science Olympiad, and you'll see that there's some overlap in terms of who does what. So Ian Wallace and Nick Whiteman and Anna Tranfaglia. Why don't you all come on up here, and I'll tell people which ones you are. This is Libby Cummings, whose sister Sarah wrote those comments about the middle school music teachers.
My sister did a good job.
This is Ian Wallace and Nick Whiteman. Senior Liam Sullivan. The senior boys are coming particularly well-dressed tonight for some reason. That's not the way they normally look in school. Morgan Alden and Anna Tranfaglia and Daniel Shedd. That's who that is. Okay. So.
Hello, and good evening. And I'm a senior, and I have participated in math competitions for all 4 years of high school, and I'm just so thrilled that Dr. Garrett has allowed us to branch out in so many different ways so quickly while I'm still in high school, and I've appreciated it immensely. Thank you.
I'm a
start talking about the North Shore Science League. North Shore Science League is a group of 32 schools, mostly like Boston and just North Shore, Massachusetts. We're the only school from Maine. And it's 6 meets a year, once a month, at various high schools in Massachusetts. And there's 3 events, and you choose one event, and they're all about an hour and a half long. And they're like chemistry, biology, engineering, physics. And last year we came in 3rd place overall and won the biology award, that's what it was, for the year. And this year we came in 1st place overall and won the miscellaneous award for like engineering projects and the chemistry award. And we just want to thank you for letting us go down, because I knew a couple years ago it was like we didn't know whether or not we'd be allowed to go down to Massachusetts every month, but we were. And as Libby and Morgan will add, it greatly helped us like prepare for other events such as National Science School and the Olympiad. And so thank you.
I'm Libby, and I've been involved in all 3 of the facets of the science team that Mr. Shudd mentioned, and I guess I'll talk about the Science Olympiad. This is a yearly, you go for a day, and it's a bunch of schools in Maine that do it. So this year we came in, I think, 4th, which is pretty good considering that we didn't really prepare very much, but we had a really good time. And it was at USM this year, so we just went for a day and, you know, got a bunch of medals, did some events. So it's just, I don't know, I just wanted to say that, like, a couple years ago when I heard that they were starting a science team, I was like, like, geeky, I don't know if I want to do that. And I've enjoyed it so much. And it's just, it's great working with these people, and I really enjoy it. So thanks for letting us do that. And National Science School.
Hi, I'm Morgan Alden, and I was one of 5 students who went down to Washington, D.C. The weekend before, to compete in the National Science Bowl. We came in 2nd in our regional bowl, and the 1st place team couldn't go because they decided to go to Hawaii for the Ocean Bowl, Marine Science Bowl. So we got to represent Northern New England in Washington, D.C., and it was a really great experience. And I just want to reemphasize again our thanks for allowing us to branch out with science activities this year, because we definitely would not have been as prepared for this National Science Bowl if we hadn't had the chance to go down to North Shore every month and compete in the Science Olympiad as well. And even though we may not have done so well in the normal competition rounds, we did surprisingly do pretty well with our hydrogen fuel cell car, and I would like Dan to present it because he mostly built it, but it was very exciting. We ended up coming in 2nd place in a speed race, and we got to have our picture taken with this giant
fake check.
Hopefully it was a real one too.
But. Yeah, the real one hasn't come yet.
It's supposed to be in the mail.
So this is the hydrogen car that I mostly built. It was sponsored by General Motors, and they brought their real size hydrogen car as well. We built it in about the 2 weeks before, and yeah, then we raced it and got 2nd place, which was a lot of fun and very unexpected because I pretty much built the simplest thing I could think of, and that ended up working, so it was a lot of fun. And I'd like to thank especially Dr. Grett for allowing us to do that. There was a lot of time for him.
I know Libby and Morgan will join me in saying that we just like to thank the whole science department. When we went to the National Science Bowl, we were not only like prepared and we studied a lot, but when we got off the plane, we got on the bus, and there's 5 other teams on the bus, and they were all guys, and we were just completely appalled. And we're like, where are all the girls at the National Science Bowl? And everyone was talking about like, oh, you have girls on your team. And we were like, well, in CAPE, like girls do really well in science, and I mean, a lot of, like, our math team, we have girls on that, too, so it's just, I don't know, it just shows that this program does really well, so thank you.
Okay, does anyone say anything?
I
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Again, if I go back to teacher comments about fellow teachers, Matt Whaley sent an email to us a few days ago, which I think is an important one. Unfortunately, Matt can't be here tonight because he had a commitment to his daughter, and the person he's writing about was unable to come. He is a brand new parent, and so he wasn't able to come, but he sent a very important letter, and I want to read it. Matt wrote, "I would like to nominate Adam Killip for recognition. Adam is a new member of the grade 5 team at Cape Elizabeth Middle School. He has injected some terrific energy into our group of teachers. Adam was instrumental in getting the Boston Science Trip organized and has volunteered countless hours so as to help children stay on track in math. He has done this by volunteering his time after school 2 days a week. His attitude and confidence toward helping children learn has been tremendous. I don't recall seeing a first-year teacher add so much to a team as well as being so organized and thorough. My observations of his class find the children both engaged and excited about learning. The lessons are both creative and challenging. He has continued to go above and beyond the call of duty in all areas, from putting together grants to coming up with and assisting on creative fundraisers for the Student Council. He also has done much of this while planning for a new baby, and that is finally here. A great job, Adam. And I would like to congratulate both Adam and Matt for making this nomination as well. And I also, I guess I'm still going. the next one I want to mention briefly is the Gabe Zimprich Poetry Symposium. For those of you who have been in Cape Elizabeth for a while, you remember that Gabe was a student in our schools who passed away, I think about 9 years ago or thereabouts. Gabe also happened to be a student at the school where I was once principal, small school in South Portland, so I've known his family for many, many years. Gabe was very interested in poetry, amongst many things. And so one of the things his family did is to establish a grant to allow students each year to become involved in writing and presenting poetry. This year, the two teachers from the high school invited a poet who has been Maine State poet for several years to come in and work with 10 students, and they work all day long for 6 hours on poetry and poetry alone. I happen to have the good fortune of getting an invitation. Unfortunately, I was one of very few adults there, but I have to tell you it was a most impressive evening. Not only did both teachers read poetry that they did, but each of the 10 students read their poems, and they each were very insightful, very meaningful poems. And I think what I heard from our former poet laureate is that he has never seen this type of a program in Maine schools before. And he was both extremely impressed with the way the students presented, how they worked during the day and kept their focus on the poetry, and the resulting poems that followed. I'm not sure if those poems are going to be made available either in the school newsletter or something like that or not, but I do have a set of pictures. I originally planned to bring a PowerPoint, but knowing the length of time, I do have a set of pictures which I'm going to pass around so you can have an opportunity to see them. There were the Laura Ellis was one of them that participated in that, and I don't think anyone else is here who participated that night. But it was a wonderful program, and the Zimpriches deserve a lot of credit for setting this up as a program which honors young people who desire to become poets. A very, very well done program. And I have one more, and this is from the middle school also. The middle school was really on this time. This is from Andrea Terrio, and what she wrote is, "I think Joe Dome should be recognized for what he does to prepare his classes for the Chewonki experience." This to me was an important one. This is a sideline to it. Having been a superintendent in Wiscasset and having known Chewonki very well, I know that Chewonki can be an amazing teaching experience and learning experience. For a few months, we've been hiking outside in Robinson Woods, working as a group, practicing some Chewonki challenges. Last week, we spent an hour and a half in the woods in the pouring rain so that kids could have an idea about the conditions and what they could be like. He also introduced them to orienteering and compass use. The kids are very lucky to have him, and I am sure will benefit hugely from the preparation at Chewonki. And then she goes on with a thought for one of the people there. Just a thought, any chance during Chewonki that Nancy, Carol, and I could get subs one day and go up to see what's happening? So also put an ad in there. But again, I congratulate Joe Doan. This is not a cheap program. It's a very expensive program. But Chewonki is one that will build the program that you want and make it work for you. The kids will be fortunate that I don't go, because every year when Wiscasset would go, I would go, and it would pour every single time I went. So I said I won't go to Chewonki anymore to ruin somebody else's trip there. But it's an amazing opportunity. In closing, I'd like to thank everyone who participated this evening, from the people who talked about the music programs to the people who have been involved in the science program. It is amazing that in such a very short time, I remember when Sean first talked to me about it, he said, I don't even know if we can go, and I don't know if we can perform there well. You went, and you performed very well, and we really congratulate you. I thank everyone who sent emails to us for recognition. It's very important, and we will continue to do this to recognize what is truly happening in our school system. So I thank everyone who participated very, very much.
Thank you, Alan. Moving to comments from the public on non-agenda items. I see most of the public is currently leaving.
I think they made all the comments.
They've made their comments. Okay, so I guess we're all set with that one. Communications, notification of resignations and retirements. Alan?
Yes. Hang on just a minute. I just laid them aside here. Okay, these are notifications only. They are not ones that you need to take a vote on, but it's just to give you information. First one is from Liz Wood, who has been custodian here at the high school for several years, and she writes that, I am sorry I didn't let you know earlier, but the days seem to fly by, and here it is May. I remember Liz and I had that discussion the other day. I will be retiring June 29th, 2007. I will be 66 shortly and hope to enjoy life with grandchildren and some travel. I hope to sub, or I need to supplement my income a little. And she added, when she talked to me, she didn't add it here, but she also thoroughly enjoys working with the high school students. And so she hopes for that. So I have approved her retirement plans. My second letter came from Mary DeFusco. Mary has been in ed tech at Pond Cove, and she writes that at this time it's necessary for me to submit my letter of resignation to be effective April 27, 2007. So I did approve it before this meeting. She had planned to end the year, but because of illnesses, she found it was not possible for her to do that. She sums up by saying, I've truly enjoyed working with the students and dedicated professional staff at Pond Cove School. So it is with mixed emotions that I leave my first grade students and the people I work with all the time. So again, somebody I'm sorry to see go. Mary also was an ed tech for me when I was principal at Memorial Middle School. So I know the type of work she does with students. The third one, which really came suddenly and really hurt badly, is from Paul Benham. And any of you who have had anything to do with the school system here know that Paul is one of our expert technology people and certainly could meet many, many challenges. He sent this letter to say that as an official notice of my intention to resign my current position of computer technician on May 11, 2007. I would like to thank you for the opportunity to working alongside yourself, and this is a letter alongside Gary, Jason, Matthew, and Ginger over the past 3 years in the Cape School District. It has been a pleasure coming to work each day here, always knowing that I would be challenged, but also knowing that my work is appreciated and valued by the staff, students, and employees that I serve. I can say without a doubt that this has been the most fulfilling job that I have ever had, and it has provided me with many opportunities to learn new skills and create new relationships with people. I would like to thank you personally for giving me the opportunity and wish you all the best in the future. If I can be of any help as you transition to a new member of your staff, please let me know. So we have just lost one of our English accents as he is gone. He has left us to go to Bates College, where he will be doing technology work there with the 35 staff members in the technology department at Bates. So we wish him well. My final one is from Marie Otis, and this was addressed to me. It is with great regret that I will not be returning to Pond Cove Elementary as a computer lab technician. I've enjoyed teaching the computer lab portion of the Allied Arts Rotation here at Pond Cove for the past 7 years, maintaining the lab and mobile lab computers as well as the building technology issues. But most of all, meeting and opening up the world of technology to all our students. It will be hard to leave my wonderful team, the Allied Arts, because they have always been supportive in all that I do, as well as Tom, who has allowed the flexibility within the lab and provided unyielding support for the lab here at Pond Cove. It was my sincere hope that someday this position would have changed to a full-time teaching position, as was discussed numerous times, but it seems to as though it is not in the future here at Pond Cove because of budget constraints, which has now left me with this most difficult decision. I've informed Tom as of today, and my end date will be the last day of school. It has been a pleasure to serve the district and Cape Elizabeth. Again, somebody who will be sorely missed, but because we have not been able to institute the computer technology program across the system, she felt that she needed to seek out other possibilities. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan.
Can I have a comment on that?
Yes.
Just because that one line did stand out to me, it was my sincere hope that someday this position would have changed to a full-time teaching position, as was discussed numerous times, but it seems as though this is not in the future here at Pond Cove because of budget constraints. I do hope that if it is something that would truly benefit the needs of the students and if there is a need for it, that we see this appear in front of us next year during the budget process. So for whatever that's worth, hopefully these things will come to us again so we can evaluate them.
Anyone else? We'll just keep you right on the hook here, Alan.
The first thing, this is superintendent's report, and my first thing is on an update of the statewide consolidation. As many of you know, if you've been watching the papers recently, the statewide consolidation program is continuing. It is my understanding that sometime this week, supposedly tomorrow or the next day, there'll be a major announcement coming out of the Department of Education. What we have been led to believe is that the department has developed a map of possibilities of combinations of districts and how that should look. I'm not sure if there's more to that or not. I did have a call the other day from the department, and their question was, can you fill me in on where Cape Elizabeth is? I had talked to them a couple of weeks ago. Interestingly, the man who called from the Department of Education will have a new student going here to Cape Elizabeth next year, so has a specific interest in Cape Elizabeth and what we're doing. I did tell him that I have had conversations with South Portland, with Freeport. I am scheduling a meeting with Falmouth, and I've been invited by Yarmouth, and Dominic has had some conversations with Scarborough. What we have done is basically talk about what kind of sharing things we could do. We have all been very nervous about talking about combining districts. I did say to the department, I think it was yesterday or Friday, I did say to them that my understanding, and only understanding because nothing has been brought up for vote, is that there is a strong feeling from both the school board and also the town council to look at the possibility of Cape Elizabeth standing alone and not becoming a part of a district. So I am very anxious to see what information we have. I'm very much aware that Answorth Kayada has been doing an enormous amount of work in Augusta with Maine Municipal. I have been doing a great deal of work with Maine School, MSMA. And so we are looking at that work, and I know Kathy has talked about the possibility of doing something with the town council to provide that information. I don't know if you want to talk a little more about that at this point.
Sure, and my idea is really just sort of an idea, but I wanted to run it by the board. I'd like to talk about maybe trying to put together, I know you guys will probably want to not be happy with me, but a committee that's involved with like the school board and some town councilors, because some of the town councilors have a lot of experience that we could, use, and we could work together as a group with maybe some other folks. Alan, obviously, and a town manager, and I don't know who else, but because it's just in the thought process. But I think it would be beneficial to both the school and the town to have a committee that is involved with both the town council and the school board, but I think I'm sensing that we may have some short time frames to do things like apply for an exemption, and I know some town councils have a lot of experience with that, and sometimes get information because of the things that they do in advance of us. So it's just an idea that I sort of wanted to float out to you folks and, you know, kind of get an idea if you thought this was something we could pursue. And so anyway.
I was going to comment. I think it's a great idea. And I also really appreciated the comments from the gentleman last night at the town meeting. Was it Mr.
Hellman?
About, I think he even took it one step farther, making not a, like a task force. But I do think it would be very beneficial for us to have these conversations and to maybe include some other people from the community who might want to give that time and have the same expertise or more expertise. We can always benefit from people who know more than us and can help us along. So I would be very open to it, and I think time is quickly ticking away, so
sure.
The sooner the better.
Does anybody have a problem with that idea? Or okay. So maybe what I can do is you and I could talk and maybe pursue it.
Certainly. Be happy.
Talk with the town council and see what they might have for interest and try to put together something and get back to you guys.
I should add comment to that. As if you've been reading the paper, you know that the Appropriations Committee is the one right now taking a look at a possible plan. They have to make a decision fairly soon. Certainly out in the state, it is felt that that decision probably will not pass because it requires a two-third vote, and so then it needs to go to the next step. Again, secondhand information only is that they're possibly the deadline, as you mentioned, Karen, is very short, as it is right now. There are some questions whether that deadline will be extended. There's some question about how this will happen, how it will happen in the major population areas of southern Maine as opposed to the less populated areas of northern Maine. There are more questions than there are answers, and I know as a superintendent, I watch daily on the Department of Education website, on the legislative website, just to see what the next steps will be. But you're right, if the timeline stays in place, our time to make decisions and move ahead, whether we are forced to join with another town or whether we stand alone, is very short, and will require some major changes as far as budgeting, as far as leadership within Cape Elizabeth, et cetera. And so I think any information we can get that will help us understand what's going on and help us understand if there are any ways to work around it is very important.
Great, thank you, Alan. Update on the turf field.
Next on the agenda is update on the turf field. I have sent to each of you as board members today my thoughts on this. I've done this differently than I normally do. As you know, many times we talk about things and I feel very strongly. I present the information to you. You make decisions, and you still do, because I do not have a vote, or I don't stand to make plans for it. But I thought a lot about it in the last few days, in the last few weeks, and decided that tonight I need to at least make a statement to the board about my perspective on where we are and where we're going. And so with your permission, I'll read this because it also goes out to the community, and I also do have extra copies if people want it at that point in time. So if you'll bear with me, I would like to have the opportunity to do this. So with your permission, I feel it is time for me to present my thoughts on the turf field. As a non-resident and as a superintendent of schools, I have no vote on this project, but I feel strongly that I have been involved from the beginning, and there are thoughts that need to be shared. My financial donation, though small, was made because of my support from the beginning, and it's a support that I have continued. To be honest, the last few weeks have not been easy. Accusations back and forth based on lack of information, questions around leadership, etc., have all taken their toll. However, I have truly spent the last few days, when time allows, reviewing every single email and document that has come my way regarding the turf field. Although it is clear that mistakes in the process were made and that I probably played a role along with many, I am also clear that every email that has come through my office has been shared with you as a board. The discussions about my illness has raised questions about the emails I should have received. However, what people do not realize is that as a superintendent, every email that comes across my desk dealing with issues of the school system is saved. because it becomes a legal document. It is shared when needed, and then it is filed in appropriate bonds. Thus, emails that might have been sent from January 30th, when I had initial surgery, to my return in March, were on my computer. They were read. They were answered when needed. Some were forwarded on, what few I had, and they were filed appropriately. Therefore, I can say to you that any one of you can walk into my office and ask, what did you send to me on September 1st of 2005? And I can pull that out and show you exactly what it was. The message that I was ill and would not be able to respond, and asking anyone to forward messages to my office, did not take away emails. They were all there and were filed as everything else. I know clearly that as a superintendent, I have the obligation and I have the responsibility to maintain these documents for further reference. I have a notebook, which is right here, that holds all of the documents that have passed from the time we began the turf field work until about 10 which have come in today. So it goes from the whole scale. Now, with that said, all of these issues are adult issues and are not worth the time and energy to continue to discuss or to engage in battles. As a superintendent, I have the same obligation with even greater expectations as I had as a teacher, as I had as an elementary principal, and as I had as a middle school principal over the last 38 years. That obligation is to the students and their education, their social emotional growth, and their welfare. With that in mind, I'm very clear that the community of Cape Elizabeth has been extremely fortunate to have a committee headed by Michael Ott and Graham Smith that has raised the money necessary to provide the students of Cape Elizabeth, now and in the future, their parents, other family members, and the community with a prized turf field. We can argue the aspects of lines, placements, etc., but the truth is, we have this gift. We need to remember that fundraising was done by the adult members of the committee. It was also done by students who were engaged in telephone canvassing. It was also done by parents, by business people, by community members, and many people outside of the community. I drove down to the high school this morning at 6 o'clock a.m. I got out of my car, and I stood there, and I looked at what has been done so far on the turf field. And it was very clear to me that I needed to send a message that strongly supports what is happening as far as the turf field is concerned. We'll end this and then come back to that, because this is just a quick presentation. As superintendent, I ask you as a school board to allow me the chance to speak to the issue this evening first and to propose that the board, as representatives of all members of the community, move to accept the field as it is. As a board, I know you feel strongly that every decision you make has a strong, positive influence on current and future students of Cape Elizabeth. We need to honor that hard work of many members of this community, including the young people, and support this turf field. Secondly, upon Michael McGovern's request, I had a very valuable meeting with Jim McFarland yesterday regarding a concession stand. As I always do, I typed up what I talked over with him and sent it to you at that point in time. After listening to the amount of work he has done individually with his group and with Keith Weatherby, the board also should back the plan as forwarded to you to allow the next steps to continue. Changes in size, usage, and oversight will return to the planning committee, and there are parts that the school board must work with the community to resolve. For instance, combinations of all booster groups into one large group to share the use of the concession stand and the profits thereof. Again, when I had the chance to hear the proposal, to ask the questions, and to know the direction, it's my duty to report that to you. And I will stress to you, I didn't write this in here, but I have always felt, I think any of you who've worked with me as a superintendent here in the last 2 years, it is always important that I listen, I hear, and I record for future use what I hear at that time. And so that's what I did yesterday as well. The discussion came to you in my summary yesterday. Therefore, I also would ask the school board to seriously consider supporting this issue as well. I will mention that earlier today, I had a phone call from Graham Smith, who is on the turf committee. What he was reporting to me is that he had indicated that he and Paul had talked, and he said that Paul had confirmed the town council had agreed last night at the meeting that the lines on the turf were no longer an issue for all of them. And I include this in this evening's information for your sake, so you know that I had that conversation. In closing, there are many issues that this project that need to be resolved. However, those resolutions must be internal and not engaged in by the entire community. You, as members of the board, need to decide the direction of the board, and I strongly recommend you seriously consider moving this plan ahead appropriately. Thank you. And I give that to you now. I'm assuming what you'll do is discuss it when it comes to the issue.
Sure.
I do it that way?
Yes.
Okay.
Sure.
Okay. Then I'm going to step aside, and I'm going to turn it back over to Mr. Eismeyer to take us to the next step.
This must be Dylan.
Actually, it's Principal Crowho today.
Yeah, I was going to say. This is the new and improved Pond Cove principal.
Dylan's had a really long day, not only being principal, but he just got back from a big game. So I will front part of this for him. He kept a log during the day, and I'm going to go down through it. And if you have questions about what's going on, you can just ask him, and you should tell him about this part. Ready? So Dylan came to school. Mom dropped you off with your sister, right? And he appointed his sister assistant principal.
There we go.
And she disappeared, went off to class.
You need to have one.
That's right. Speaking of budget.
Consolidation. Consolidation.
I'll read it. Then he says, I checked my email. He had an email account today, and he had 4 emails as soon as he started his day, so it was very realistic. And he had a cell phone, which bedeviled us all day because we couldn't figure it out. 8:30, I went to the media center to make an appointment to see Mrs. Balsa O'Meara about getting a new water fountain. That was an email just to you. What was that about?
It was about getting a water fountain outside of the media center in the hall.
So it was just an appointment at first because
Then
he had to go back in the afternoon. Okay. 8:45, I learned that it was security day and I had to check all the teachers' ID badges. Mrs. Perkins reminded me. Some teachers had to go to the office and get a temporary ID. Can you show people with this, or can you read it for us?
I work here, but I forgot my ID today. I will remember tomorrow.
Thank you very much. That's nicely done. I appreciate that.
I showed grade 1 class how to blow bubbles because it's a tradition to have kids chew gum and wear hats all day. You also had emails from teachers. Could they chew gum and wear hats? Mm-hmm. What did you tell them?
Yes.
They could do that. Yeah. I went to grade 4 and showed grade 4 class how to blow bubbles. I answered questions about the rules. Then we had to go to Cumberland Farms. We ran out of gum. So we, and it turned out to be a bigger story. And when we got to Cumberland Farms and bought the gum, what did the manager tell you?
They had sold over 1,000 pieces of gum that day.
They want a heads up next time. I got back to my office and I answered my email. We had a little difficulty with the connection occasionally, right? But you got through that. I went to the middle school to meet the assistant principal and I checked on ID badges there. And the middle school teachers were not happy about that. But, you know. Mr. Shields, you had to help him? Your little discipline incident with the high school, I understand. What were the high school kids doing?
They were hitting tennis balls over the fence at the kids that were running across the field.
Yeah. Oh. But the solution was to keep the tennis balls. So that was well done. Mr. Shields was appreciative. Help Mr. Shields. I went to grade 1 recess with my assistant principal. I guess they had to catch up with each other. I ate lunch with grade 1 and my assistant principal. 12:15, Mrs. Perkins asked me to use the bubble wand for grades 2 and 3 at recess. I think you did a good job with that.
Yeah.
I helped supervise the lunchroom. That got you through to lunch, right?
Yeah.
1 o'clock, I helped the third grade line coming back from lunch. I gave out more gum to fourth graders who forgot to bring some. I used the bubble wand again outside. 1:20, I checked my email again and worked on this report. 1:30, back to the playground. And then I got a very interesting email. What was the gum is good email? It's from the school nurse.
The nurse said one liked the gum idea because it was helping kids that had loose teeth get their teeth out.
Seven. to the staff. I met with Mrs. Bolso Amira, and then I think you, speaking of budget again, you approved the water fountain?
Yeah.
And something else that I didn't know about.
An extra bookshelf for the paperback books, because there's too many of them.
Yeah. And then it was time, and usually besides gum and hats, there's always some negotiation about homework, but I didn't hear many kids ask, and then at 2:45, what did you do?
I announced that there will not be homework.
Pretty smart, because some of the teachers don't like that. At 2:45, there's not much that can be done. So. And then you were off, you got on the bus, went home, and then you went to Little League and came in. Thanks for coming. I thought you did a great job.
So, you're welcome.
And he's willing to field a few questions, but I know, you know, Mom and the assistant principal and Dad's here. Probably want him to go home pretty soon. Any questions for him? He did a great job.
Yeah.
I will apologize. I'm the superintendent of the schools. I started an email to you earlier this morning, and I was upstairs a few minutes ago and realized I never got it finished and sent to you. But I just was emailing you to wish you good luck in keeping Pond Cove in good order today, and thank you.
Great. Nice job.
Did you like...
Oh, we got more.
Did you like being the principal for the day?
Yes.
Do you think it's a job you could do when you're a little older?
Maybe.
Do you have appreciation for what Mr. Eismeyer does now?
Yes.
You did a great job. Well, Jim Rowe asked him one year if the job was worth up to, you know, up to $10 a day. Do you think it was worth about 10 bucks? More? Less?
Maybe a little more.
A little more.
A little more.
Anybody else?
I bet the fourth graders would appreciate a water fountain there. I heard a statistic the other day that it's 0.2 miles from the office to the far end of the fourth grade wing.
Yeah. It's actually a good idea. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Great. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dylan.
Thank you.
I'm still on, aren't I?
Yes, I think maybe we should give out to the highest bidder, the superintendent, for the day.
That would be, that's fine. Today would have been a good day. I would offer that at any moment, as a matter of fact.
We'll have to negotiate what the price will be, though.
Yeah. $15. Yeah.
Okay.
I think
it's about what it's worth.
The only administrator that has got such a good
deal. That's probably true.
Yeah, that's true.
That's probably true. The last two items that I have in the superintendent's report are one that we talked about at our last workshop meeting. And that is setting guidelines on grant proposals. I'm not going to go through and read the whole thing to you, but basically what it does is if a grant proposal goes to any agency for further fund that includes further funding from the school board during the life of the grant, then there is a series of steps that you need to go through in order to do that. That includes sharing the grant with me so that I know what is happening, to go to the grant proposal, to bring it to the board so that the board understands what the plans are. And once it is, it gets a final vote from the grant provider, then it comes back to the school board for acceptance. And so this is when you have to put in money for that. The other type of grant is fully funded by the funding organization. It's a little different in that case, in that what you're looking at is somebody receiving a grant that will be funded by the organization, and they will manage it, and they will report back to the organization, and it will be no hidden cost to the school board. However, I feel very strongly that I, as a superintendent, need to have that information with questions, and I feel strongly that you, as a school board, need to know what those grants were. So if there are further questions on what that process is, et cetera, that you'd be able to accept it. And so those were the two that I had presented to you, and my recollection was that I should bring them to you and just pass them by you and let you know what is happening. But in that process, Tom Eismeyer has recently received a grant from CEF, which a one-year grant, which will fund a mathematics program, and it will not require any money from the board. So I have let him know that grant is accepted and that he will get back to CEF and start that money a rolling, and so that we will have that. But again, I can't stress enough that the need for grants, whether CEF or any other organization, are very important to us as money becomes more and more difficult at the community level. And these, all of these grants that we do are to enhance what is going on in the classroom above and beyond what the school boards should be spending. And that's a very important division, is that there are things that have to be and should be paid for by the school committee through your budget and therefore through town hall. And there are those things that enhance our curriculums that we go out to get in order to do the work we need to do. And I congratulate Tom for that. I also know I've talked with Shari today. I've talked with several people who have grant proposals out that are offering some amazing opportunities for the town of Cape Elizabeth and their students above and beyond what the school board and town council approve.
Thank you for putting that together, Alan. I think that makes it a little clearer what the process is, and it keeps you in the loop and keeps us in the loop so that there's no surprises. So.
I, as you know, I feel very strongly that good, solid information is very important to share. Okay, I'm going to do one more, and then I'm going to quit for a while. My last one is on the budget. As you know, I developed a budget earlier this year and went to the school board. The school board then presents it to the town council. Has gone before the town council in two meetings last week, and then last night there was a meeting on that budget and also on the bonding issues that we proposed in the budget. The town council will then take it to a vote, which I believe, I'm looking at Paul to be sure I'm saying this right, on May 14th, and that will be the vote. At this point in time, our understanding is they have not voted on it. They've only looked at for consensus. But the understanding right now is that it will be a 3.0 budget. Percent budget. It will mean that we as a school system will have to find almost $44,000 to cut. Fortunately, the work of the bonding has saved us from a cut which could have amounted to $237,000. So that is where we're at. I did not plan to talk with you tonight about what we're going to cut. I really need to know what that budget is going to look like first, and then I will bring to you the cut proposals and what we're looking at. I will say to you that $43,000 is certainly a lot different than $237,000, but I think it will also continue to have some impact on the staffing of our schools. And so I'll be very clear on that as we go along. Those are the reports that I have under the superintendent's report.
Okay, thank you, Alan. Moving on to school reports, middle school report on advisor-advisee program. Is this Gary?
That's Gary.
He's been waiting patiently for an hour and 20 minutes.
I'll pass these down.
I did think it was going to be earlier, but that's okay.
I didn't quite realize we had so many recognitions.
What I'd like to do is give you a little background on where we started this summer with our advisor-advisee planning and the reason for that. And then I have a couple of grade levels to give you some idea of where we are this year with it and what we've been doing and where we've been going. And watching the young people that have come up to the podium tonight makes my job doing this a whole lot easier, right? Because I can sum it up, and that's how I plan on summing it up at the end. We met this summer. I think we had three work days in the summer, and basically we met with Steve Conley, a team of two representatives from each grade level, and we knew that advisor-advisee, which it was called in the 7th and 8th grade, homeroom guidance, which it was called in the 6th grade, and I'm not sure what it was called in the 5th grade, but I know they did something there. And the whole idea was to get it organized tighter so we knew what each grade level was doing, to kind of get away from some of the repetition that was happening with activities that they might be doing throughout their 4-year span. And also really tightening what it was that they were doing at each grade level to get it more defined. And basically what came out of that with each grade level was a packet of activities for each grade level, so that if you had a new teacher coming on board, or if you teachers that were already on board, whatever activity it was that you were going to run during advisor, advisee, or homeroom guidance, every teacher would be aware of those pool of activities, and they know how to do them. We were real clear that some got more involved in it than others. In sixth grade, those of us that had gone up to Chewonki and were familiar with some of the activities up there felt more comfortable running those kinds of activities with our sixth graders. We could share it with the ones that didn't. But this really put everything into writing. And what I've really noticed in the sixth grade, when an activity is going on, I can look out the window and see somebody that wasn't doing an activity in years past doing it. And they're very, very, very organized, will come to each other. But you can see from the descriptions that are in there that it's written out pretty plainly for everyone to see. And that's a folder that will grow as the activities grow. And each of those, in each grade level, we decided that the theme would be the three R's, right? And that's respect, responsibility, and resourcefulness. And those activities that we came up with, the respect that the kids got from each other would be in working through something as a group, listening to other people's points of view, respecting other people's strengths, respecting their weaknesses. Responsibility is just your job within the group in getting whatever activity done it is. And the resourcefulness, that's a piece that I think comes later individually with different children. But the resourcefulness we wanted to get out of the respect and the responsibility was, what do you do with this respect and responsibility once you've kind of gained it and you've got an idea of what it is? And that resourcefulness is going out into your community or doing something with your family and recognizing that, yeah, I should be doing this. Without a teacher saying, well, let's have this kind of fundraiser or this. Right? And we have more and more kids coming to us now saying, can we do this? Can we have this kind of activity to raise money for a certain cause or so forth? And that's what we really are looking for more in the sixth grade. I'm going to the packet here with the sixth grade, and I'm not going to read through it. But it has a rationale in there that each of the grade levels has for why we should have advisory at this grade level or any grade level. I've got we've got a list of 30 activities that we've come up with for the sixth grade there. There's also five big activities that we do if weather permits. We get two walks down into Robinson's Woods with the entire sixth grade. If weather is just absolutely brutal and we can't go like it was this winter, we have a backup. They do survival board games, and we do the L.L. Bean survival activity where a plane crashes and you've only got so many items left, and they work together individually to figure it out, then in pairs and then in groups, and they get an idea of working in a group and listening to people's ideas and so forth. There's five sample write-ups in there of what the actual write-ups look like, so when a teacher looks at them. And then there's some debriefing methods that we use, and those are very similar to what they use up at Chewonki. So anytime they do an activity, we talk about the respect and responsibility in the beginning and why we're doing it. And then when we debrief an activity, we have kids actually look at their role in it, what went well, what didn't go well, right, so on and so forth. Right. I also have to share from the eighth grade. Steve Price could not be here tonight. His daughter came down with severe strep throat, and he had to take her to the hospital today. And this kind of shows you a little bit of evolution. And this happened, you know, just this year in eighth grade from doing what we did this summer. As part of an effort to continually shape and update our advisor-advisee program, the eighth grade faculty has created a weekly activity called Project Thursdays. The idea behind this new piece of curriculum is to give students and teachers a chance to experience some different hobbies and interests together to foster another aspect of the relationship between teacher, advisor, adults and student, advisee, adolescent. Teachers brainstormed ideas of activities that could be offered over the course of about 10 half-hour meetings on Thursdays during the last trimester. And one thing that the seventh and eighth graders really grappled with their advisor-advisee program is having enough time to really get something done. They do meet daily for 15/20 minutes, and one thing that we have in the sixth grade, even though we only meet once a week, is that we have a full half hour to really get a meaningful activity done. And eighth grade kind of jumped on that and found a way that they could get 2 days a week, right, where they could get a half an hour. The groups were formed, and we've had some positive feedback from staff and student alike. Teachers brainstormed ideas of activities that could be offered over the course of about 10 half-hour meeting times. Then students were asked to pick their top three choices from a list of 12. The groups were formed, and we've had some positive feedback from staff and students alike. It has given all of us a chance to share a part of ourselves that our content area teaching assignments don't, and has given the kids a chance to try some things they might not ordinarily get a chance to try. The seventh grade team would like to implement a similar program next year, so we hope to use some summer professional work time to plan an expanded version for the next school year. The rest of our advisor-advisee program remains intact, with its emphasis on advisor-to-parent-student-teacher communication, adolescent behaviors and concerns, and community service. A list of the current Project Thursday offerings is attached. And I'll just... The things that the kids had a choice of doing, pleasure reading and writing, a fitness class, recycling environmental group, sports film history, power walk around Cape Elizabeth, which I'm going to have to do this week for Mr. Casey, right? game extravaganza, theater games and production, scrap it, which is scrapbooking, laptop exploration, and eat for life, which is talking about obviously good eating habits and so forth, and looking into that. And I commend Steve for getting us together this summer and really pulling this together. This will be my 15th year in sixth grade, and I know it's been a little easier in sixth grade because we could always focus our activities around Chewonky. We always had that hub. And you heard a letter today from somebody, you know, Joe taking people down into the woods and doing that, and other people are doing that also. I end this with thinking that our advisor-advisee program, that's the one thing that we have at Cape Elizabeth Middle School that makes it a middle school. Take that away, and I know you're not asking us to take that away, but if you take that away, then basically we've got a junior high concept, or we've got a mini high school. And I use the two young ladies that came up here and spoke about the high school music program. I had one of those young ladies 7 years ago in my Chewonky group, right? And I think in the whole week, she might have said 4 or 5 words. Right? And the other one, I know from in sixth grade, but never had in a class, probably wouldn't have said a word. But what struck me was, in their conversation, when they were talking about their high school choral teachers and the high school and Mr. Lazotte, they recognized how those two respected each other. Right? They recognized how on top of things they were and how organized they were, the responsibility. And they recognized the resourcefulness and the things that they did that made the program interesting for them. And it's a cumulative thing. Right? I'm teaching eighth grade this year this week for Mr. Casey while he's up at Chewonky, and I've got kids that are 2 years removed from when I had them before, and I've got them in an advisor-advisee program. Right? And kids that weren't talking a couple of years ago are talking more this year. Right? It's a valuable program. Steve's done a lot to pull it together and get it organized, and anytime you can look at a little sixth grader and then see them up here as seniors and what they're doing. And they get this growth from all the opportunities they get outside the classroom. Right. Any questions? Yes?
Just a couple comments. First, I want to thank you for your dedicated years to Chewonky. I think this is the first year you're home and dry this week.
This is the first time I haven't gone up in 14 years.
I was going to say that. So thank you for your dedication to the program. Also, I just want to thank you and the middle school staff for all you've done in this program, because some of the themes that came out of this, a lot of the strategic planning communication discussions and meetings that we had, were the importance and the value that we place on climate in our schools, and that how important it is for kids to connect to adults. And I think sometimes those advisory periods, as short as they are, allow kids to do that, and also how kids learn in different environments and different learning styles. And advisory may be where they develop, particularly those Thursday, I think that's such a great idea, where they can sort of build in self-confidence in a skill or an interest that they might have. It allows them to flourish in different environments. So thank you for working with the time constraints and the other things that you have to sort of beef up the program.
All right. Thank you.
Anybody else? Thank you very much, Gary. And thank you for sticking with us for an hour and a half. Moving on to unfinished business, policies for second reading. Trish.
The first policy we have is gate receipts and admissions. I don't believe there were any comments at the first reading.
Trish, unfortunately, there's a typo in the second paragraph. Charges should be charged. Sorry.
I don't think a typo, does a typo warrant a revote? We can just fix the typing. Okay. So noted. With the typing correction, I'd like to move that we approve policy DFD on gate receipts and admissions.
Is there a second? Thank you, Peter. Any discussion? All in favor? 5-0.
The next policy is policy FF, which is a naming of school facilities. And I don't believe there were any comments on that at the first reading. Also, I guess, since we're doing that, the guidelines and procedures, I know we don't technically have to vote on, but I do not believe there were any comments on that as well. So I would like to move that we approve policy FF, naming of school facilities, as presented.
Second. Thank you, Linda. Any discussion? All in favor? 5-0.
Policy JICB, which is care of school property. I believe that the only recommendation at the first reading was a renaming of the policy. It used to say care of school property by students, and we really felt that it should apply to everyone. And that was the same situation with this follow-up guidelines, JICB-R. So I would like to move that we approve care of school property policy JICB as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
Linda? Any discussion? All in favor? 5-0.
Last policy, I guess we have to formalize this naming. JJIBC, relations with booster organizations. There were comments at the first reading, and those have been highlighted for you and what the changes are. And they basically dealt with the frequency of the meetings and clarification that boosters do not pay coaches directly, but they provide the funds for coaches. So with that said, I would like to move that we approve policy JJIBC, relations with booster organizations, as presented.
Is there a second?
No second.
Karen, any discussion? All in favor? 5-0. Just a quick side note, this is going to be presented to the boosters
as soon as I can get the meeting set.
Right. Yeah. I remember you talking about that.
Still trying, but the budget has stolen a lot of time, so I'll get back to that.
Okay. I just was trying to refresh my own memory, so thank you. Oh, okay. That was it, isn't it? Yes, sir. Move business, 11A. Did you write down what 11A was?
That's the discussion of possible vote on turf field in concession stand.
Okay. Would anybody like to say something?
Are we voting? Do you need a motion?
Yes, I think we should probably Yeah, if you want to make a motion, then we can open it up for discussion.
Based on superintendent's earlier comments, I would like to move that we, how do I phrase this? That we support the ongoing progress with the turf field as it is.
Okay.
Should we get a little more specific that we will support the installation of the turf field as the materials are delivered on site?
That sounds better. I withdraw it. I'm going to let Linda do the motion.
Go ahead. I move that the school board approve the installation of the turf field based on the materials delivered on site, and that we will be open to discussion of an expansion of the progress of the project as it evolves. Thank you. That was really rough.
I'm wondering if we still need more clarity in what we're approving in our motion.
Well, I think we probably do, only because I know that the lines have been an issue, and I think my understanding is that there are folks out there that would like to know where the school board stands on the lines.
Shall we make it two separate motions then?
Yeah.
As the project stands and then any future expansion on the project?
Yeah, that's probably.
I'm just raising the question.
You're not going to make another motion.
Okay. We're going to try this one more time.
Well, Peter's looking like he might make a motion.
No.
No? Okay.
Please. Well, I'll make a motion.
All right.
That we accept the turf field as is, moving forward with what has come before us and what has been presented. That is my motion.
Could you say it again, please?
I'm glad you asked.
I got the first two.
I would like to make a motion to accept the turf field as is.
That's fine.
Has been presented to us by our superintendent.
So you're making a motion to accept the superintendent's recommendation? Is that what your motion is? Okay.
We can rephrase it that way.
Well, that's a good way to do it.
Mm-hmm. I'm not trying to put words in you.
No, I think that's an excellent motion.
Okay, is there a second?
I'll second.
All right, Trish. Now we can discuss it. Does anybody wish to discuss it? I will. I have some questions, and I don't know if Alan has the answers, but
we'll try.
First of all, you mentioned receiving a phone call.
Yes.
Today. Would you mind reading that piece over again?
Yep. That Graham Smith called me this afternoon, indicated he had talked to Paul McKinney, and Paul had confirmed that the town council agreed last evening at that meeting that the lines on the turf field were no longer an issue for all of them. And I included that information in this evening's information. It's a new piece I got this afternoon.
Okay. Paul, do you want to speak to that?
I would like to, please.
Thank you.
I saw the email. That's why I came down.
I thought maybe that was why you arrived.
I want to clarify my own comments because I didn't speak to Alan.
Yeah.
And as we all know, things get interpreted as they go from person to person.
Agreed.
So what my comments were and what I intended is, I can't speak for other councilors. I'm the chairman of the council, but I can't speak for other councilors. But what happened, and we didn't take a vote on any of this, but what happened is we informally discussed this, and there was a consensus among the council that we would leave it to you, the school board, to decide what you want to decide. We heard the presentation, and I think several school board members were there, from Kids Turf Field, but we didn't take a formal vote. What we determined was that really, we don't want to be in front of the school board if there are going to be any changes. If you want to make changes, you need to figure out what they might be, and then it'll come back to us. But we don't, as far as we were concerned, the consensus was we were going to let you guys handle that issue because we didn't want to be in front of you. Now, we did hear from the Kids Turf Committee. Kathy and I exchanged emails a week or so ago, and you had emailed Michael, but it really was directed toward me, the comment.
Referenced, right.
And so I responded, and what I stated in the email simply was that contracts have already been signed for the lines that were submitted by the Kids Turf Committee, or recommended by them to the manager. Manager had signed contracts, so we're obligated for that. And any changes would be costly, but as the manager presented, I'd say, was a week and a half ago, changes are possible, but they will be expensive. So, the bottom line, the consensus, and what I was trying to say, and actually what happened with Graham, I just happened to bump into him here at the town hall when I was coming here to meet Michael. He was out in the parking lot. I said hello to him, and then we just exchanged comments. He asked me about the lines. I said, well, it's really in the school board's court right now, and you know, we're not going to move forward without their feedback. So we didn't take a formal vote, and like I said, I can't speak for the other councilors because we didn't do that. But there was a consensus that we weren't going to handle that issue unless you guys came back with something else. Does that answer the question or clarify it at all?
I think it. Go ahead.
If I can just take another step. Whenever I receive a phone call, one of the things I'm very careful of is I keep notes as I talk.
Oh, sure.
And so when Graham called, and I think he stopped upstairs first, and then I got a message that he wanted me to call him.
Sure.
And when I talked to him, what I took the message that he gave me, and the message he gave me was that he had understood from the conversation with you that I think the word, I'd have to go upstairs and get my notes, but I think the words were that the town council had either yielded or there may have been another word there.
Yeah.
That was not an issue. But I think the other issue that I need to bring up, and I unfortunately Michael is away, but what I have understood right along is that the turf, the actual installation of the turf, the payment, all of those things are a town council decision because it's financial.
That's correct.
What I'm understanding is the piece that the town council wants from us is to get a message about whether we feel we need to go ahead or not. I have really struggled with this whole issue of the lines because I don't really think that is a board decision. That is a contract. I have the contract right here, the adjustment.
Yeah, we've already contracted. That's part of the issue. And what I said to Graham also is I said, because the school board's going to handle that, you may want to speak to them. So I just left it open-ended, and I went about my way. And apparently he did communicate with you, and you communicated in return. The contracts have been set. The Kids Turf Committee did their research, made their recommendation. The manager said fine and moved forward. But at this point, because of the controversy, we don't want to stir up more controversy. So we're saying, look, it's on school grounds. You guys are going to, you need to have a say. And we already discussed the issue of opening the communication lines better and reestablishing the other committee. That's in the works, just so you know. And we just don't want to get in the way. So the consensus on the council is let the school board deal with the line issue, if it is an issue, in fact. And then we'll, if it comes back, then we can figure it out. So that's about it. Any?
Can I, first of all, I want to thank you for the clarification, because I think that's very helpful, because you do hear different things.
You do, invariably.
I guess I'm confused, because if this really isn't a school board issue, then I don't see how it's appropriate for us to vote specifically how we feel about the lines. So I would be most comfortable letting the town council vote on that, since that seems to be, what I'm understanding, seems to be in the town council domain. However, I believe our issue had more to do with process and,
right,
and communication, and wanting, okay, to be kept in the loop. And if indeed I would like to work toward that being implemented, and not voting on things that perhaps are not in our domain or jurisdiction or whatever you want to call it. So that is my opinion.
Karen, I totally agree. The process and the communication has been an issue, and I apologize. If we had hindsight, in hindsight, we can see we could have done much better. However, it is where it is today, and we are working to fix the process and the communication. That won't break down again, I don't believe, because we're going to fix that issue. With respect to the lines, even though it is, the decision's already been made. Now, the question is, do we want to change the decision or alter it in some fashion? And what I was trying to point out is, we were just simply listening to information. I wasn't on that committee. I don't know the process that they used, but I do know that they were very thorough, very committed, and trying to be very fair. And they explained themselves pretty well last night. Trish, you were there. I don't know who else was there. I wasn't paying close attention. Oh, everybody was there. Okay, good. But I remember Trish because she came up here to speak. So in their explanation, it seemed to me to be a very logical argument in terms of how they came up to the conclusion. Should we alter that? And we can. We're just going to have to pay for it. That's the essence of it. It's fairly expensive process, and I'm not sure it's beneficial, but if people feel strongly that it should be, you know, we can do it. Anything's possible, but we just have to understand what the implications are. That's all.
Well, and that brings me back sort of to my questions. And I'm not trying to belabor the point, because, you know, I recognize that there was a communication problem, and I think we're talking about not letting that go forward, and that's the most important.
Yeah, I agree.
To me. But I come back with my sense is that there's a rush on the lines, and I had asked a question, and I'm not sure I understood if there was an answer about when does it have to be decided if lines are going to be changed, because if I understand correctly, the field that is rolled up in a ball in the high school parking lot has some of the permanent lines on it, but not all of the permanent lines. And I'm looking back and forth because I'm not sure.
I've read most of the relevant emails. I shouldn't say all, because I never know if I've read all of them. My understanding, Kathy, and I'll try to speak as best I can for Michael, because he's not here, unfortunately. I know he wanted to be, but he couldn't be.
He's on a plane, right?
He's on a plane. But I'll do the best I can for him. The bottom line is, they made these decisions. They made a contract. There's a process the field goes through when they're going to put permanent lines, tufting, and so it's prepped for those lines. All of that factory work has been done for those particular lines that were committed to. So that to undo that would be significant, in my understanding. To add additional permanent lines is feasible. Their argument, the Kids Turf Committee, was that the two sports they did not include out of the six were because of potential rule changes. Apparently one is girls lacrosse that has a very serious potential of changing the rules in the near future. And the other one was girls' field hockey, where the rules have changed twice in the last 6 years. That's the information they shared with us. And they, what they would do is seasonally paint those lines. So can those lines be added? Sure they can. And there's just an additional expense, and we'll figure out, you know, how we could pay for that.
Go ahead.
On that note, one, if we didn't approve them, we then are basically sending the message to the fundraising people that you've got to raise another $15,000 per sport.
Well, I don't think there's a determination how it, that would be paid for, but it's 15,000, I think, was at the low end.
That's sort of the implied.
It could be.
Or, Eador, if they're the ones who are going to pay, and it takes them a while to raise 15,000 because they've worked so hard to raise as much as they have,
yeah,
that sits in a ball in the parking lot indefinitely.
Well, I don't think we want to stop the process. I mean, we've got people, I go down there every day lately to see how the progress is coming, because there's a huge commitment here, and they're really moving ahead quickly. I don't think we want to stop that, because all these contractors are getting paid to work, and you can't back out of that.
I guess that's what I'm trying to clarify. Is this a moot point? I mean, well, do we really even have the option of voting to stop the process?
No, really. Not stop the process, but to add the lines, yes.
But by doing that,
it'll prolong
point
the process.
D says they could, it could sit in the parking lot, and or we have to wait until another $15,000 to $30,000 is raised.
I don't know what the length of time would be, Trish. I think when we heard the engineer, I thought he said you put the surface down and then you cut it somehow and reinstall those lines. I'm not really sure about that. I can't give you a good answer.
And from the perspective that I have, and I listened very carefully to Andrew Manning the other night.
Andrew Manning, yes.
Because I feel we have to trust him. He has been hired to engineer this, so I really put a lot of trust in what he has to say. And my understanding is when that field is ready for the turf, we need to get the turf down before there's other settling and those types of things. For me, the issue has been the question of the lines, and that was a question that really boiled up very quickly recently. But going back to what I see on this document and what I understand is on the other document is there have been documents signed that move this ahead. And that is why I feel very strongly, and I continue to feel very strongly, that as a school board, what the school board needs to do is give the permission for the project to continue as it is set at this point in time. What I need to do is reflect it in the minutes of my meetings, because one of the things that I see, the minutes of our meetings really set the agenda for things we do later on. This is a whole new issue that, as far as I can find out in talking with many different people, has never been played out quite this way before. And so the difficulty of the issue becomes the school board, it has been put in our hands. I am very concerned that it not be such a big issue that we are the final decision makers, because my understanding is historically, what has happened if there's been a big fundraising, that it is turned over to the town council, and then the town council moves from there to make the decisions that are necessary. That the part the board plays is to just approve what's going on and to do the work that we need to do, like, for instance, the fundraising, the booster information, which there have been an enormous amount of hours put into that. But my picture of it is, and again, you all know that every one of us has a picture based on secondhand information. But from what I have been able to ferret out from this is that I have to revise the board, and then they make their decisions however they want to do it as far as what are the next steps. And what I'm understanding as far as the field itself is concerned is that the board can choose, I'm not saying they have to choose, but can choose to approve the laying of the turf as it has been delivered according to the contracts that were signed.
Absolutely.
And that there, the other pieces to the puzzle, which are painting or whatever else, come with that. And therefore will happen later on. That's my understanding, because I fear that this new level of debate and understanding is going to get very murky if we're not really careful with the responsibilities of each. And what has been certainly beaten into my head, and I don't mean that as bad as it sounds, but what I've certainly heard is that the history in Cape Elizabeth is that the fields belong to the town. And I'm looking at Sue because she's somebody who's been very much involved with that. And the school committee has the responsibility of setting the rules and regulations of how it's used, the parking, and those types of things. Am I in cold water on that, Sue, or am I? That's what I've understood from the past.
You're absolutely right, Alan. And I think the issue has become a communication issue, as Karen pointed out. And that's our concern, is we don't want to be perceived as steamrolling the school board and the decision making. When it came to the council, our understanding was it had been vetted through all of the school layers. Now we're at a point where we find out that maybe the process needs some reorganization, and communication needs to improve. And that's why we're here at this point. That's why the council really did not... We have accepted the turf field, but we haven't made any changes, and we don't want to make any changes without school board input. That's what we're suggesting. We all would agree that the Kids Turf Committee has done an outstanding job. It's unbelievable. And we're going to have a great turf field. So if you have any further input, we need to know so that we can make any appropriate changes. That's the bottom line. And I think that's what Michael would tell you if he was here.
So. I'd like to yield to Karen. I believe she has a motion for the board to consider.
We have a motion on the...
I think this might even be clearer.
Okay, so are you withdrawing your motion?
I'd like to make a motion to withdraw my former motion.
Linda has a motion, though.
You have a motion.
All right. Go ahead, Karen. Thank you, Paul.
I'd like to present this motion that I would like the school board, I would like to make a motion that the school board approve the laying of the turf field as it has been delivered and to keep the process regarding the turf field moving forward.
In accordance with contract terms that have been negotiated to date.
Okay. In accordance with contract terms that have been negotiated.
Which have been committed to. Not even negotiated, committed to. Is that a better?
I think that's pretty accurate. Absolutely.
Okay. Did you get that, Mary?
I hope so. Let me read it back to you. Make a motion that proceed with laying the turf field as it has been delivered in accordance with the commitments made. Is that right? No?
That the school board approve the laying of the turf field as it has been delivered and to keep the process moving forward as you finish that.
As
in accordance with just the last part that you said.
Contractual obligations.
Okay. You have that, Mary?
All right.
Is there a second? Trish. Okay, now, would you like to have anybody discuss? I can't. Yes.
Can I say a couple words?
Yes, please. Trish.
I had a long conversation, but a conversation with Keith about this today, Keith Weatherby, the athletic director. And I just wanted to throw in, for what it's worth, Keith's views about the lines. And I think if he were here, I think he would make a plea to both the school board and the town council to make a more explicit motion to support the lines as they are set forth in the contract. And to just say that really explicitly, and I think he would say the same thing to the town council as well, to say, let's just be really clear about it. Keith's original preference, as the board knows, was to have a green field. And there are a number of reasons for that, and there's good arguments on both sides of that, whether you should have a green field or permanent lines. Granted that permanent lines are going to be on the field of one sort or another, the contract has already been signed for them, The decision about which lines would be drawn, although the communications weren't as perfect as they should have been, Keith's opinion, if he expressed it to you today, if he were here today, would be that the decisions that were made were the right decisions. And I think that the major issue for Keith is again, just as I can't remember who brought it up, is that there have been changes in the girls' lines historically, more changes in the girls' lines than the boys' lines, so that if all of a sudden there are changes that are made to the lines again and there are some serious changes that are under discussion, at least in girls' lacrosse, I'm not sure about field hockey, that the school, the town, everybody, the kids, would have a real problem on its hand if we have lines that don't permanent lines that don't match the new guidelines that the governing bodies of field hockey and girls lacrosse would establish. So the decisions are the right ones in Keith's view, as the expert that the school board hires to sort of take a look at these issues. Keith is very confident, and I'm sure if he were here today, because he was very adamant with me that the way he's looking at the schedule, every single varsity game of all of these sports, football, girls and boys lacrosse, girls and boys soccer, and field hockey will all be played on the turf field equally. All of the lines will be there. The lines for girls lacrosse and field hockey will be painted on at the beginning of the season, and the irony of this discussion is probably that those lines over the next year or two will begin to look better than the lines that are permanent, because if the lines that are permanent are going to start to fade at some point, whereas the lines that are not permanent will be fresh from year to year. So for all those reasons, I mean, I think Keith would make a proposal without trying to get into, and I'll say that I agree with his viewpoint as well. He persuaded me to this today. That regardless of whose responsibility is, where the communications breakdown or whatever it would be, that it's in the kids' best interest, and it's the community's best interest, and the school board's best interest, the town council's best interest, it's in everybody's best interest. They say explicitly the lines are the lines that should be there, the lines that are provided on the contract. And now I'm going to editorialize on something else that I that I hope it doesn't muddy the water at all. But I will just also say, and I think I'm almost positive Keith would agree with me on this, that I personally, as the school principal concerned about that field and what a wonderful asset that can be, think that without bleachers, that field is going to be lose tremendous amount of public value. It's easy to think about a field without bleachers like we have at the varsity soccer field because there's a hill that rests way up on top of the field. So you can, without bleachers, see the field, see the play on the field wonderfully. If you can imagine upwards of 2,000 people, Keith has convinced me that there will be, perhaps, at some point in time, upwards of 2,000 people. I'm not saying there needs to be as bleachers for 2,000 people, but 2,000 people within the space between where that fence is going to be around the immediate perimeter of the turf field and the outer perimeter, which is going to mark where gate receipts are collected, you're going to have 2,000 people sort of milling and sort of jockeying for position to try to be able to see the play on the field. So beyond, above and beyond the lines, I guess I would just say, and I believe I'm reasonably confident Keith would agree with me, is that it seems to me, to both the school board and the town council as well, without my getting into the turf issues around those issues and acknowledging that there have been communications issues, to have somebody approve what Michael McGovern put out originally, which was an amount to go to a bond up to a certain amount, and then with the design to be figured out between the school board, the town council, Kids Turf, and other folks at some point, because the field is going to lose a lot of value and there's going to be a lot of chaos within the field with people milling around if there is not the orderly progression of bleachers that sort of go up in rows that allow people to see without standing over one another or bringing periscopes. So I would urge at some point for that issue to be addressed explicitly as well by both the school board and the town council.
Jeff, you haven't muddied the waters. You've thrown us into the swamp.
You've thrown us into the swamp.
Then perhaps you can deal with those issues separately. And I would suggest, you know, the bleachers issue is another issue. But the lines issue, I think the right way to deal with it is to say we approve the field with the lines as contracted, as presumably are out on the rolls out there on the field right now, and that's the way to go. That's in everybody's best interest.
And to speak to that, I think the motion that we put forth covers that.
But you're saying he wants terminology.
What I'm just saying is that I'm just afraid that when that motion that goes before the town council and the subject, it doesn't explicitly say that including the lines as drawn can be interpreted as ambiguous by the town council, and are we going to then get back and there's going to be further delay. I think, according to Keith, those rolls of turf that are next to the field right now are going to start, are scheduled to be installed starting late this week, like within a couple days.
Sue?
I've been scribbling. I will make my own attempt if you want to clear the table and start.
Yes, we will clear the table.
I'd like to echo everything that Jeff said, and I'd particularly like to comment on the bleachers, and I know that's not an issue tonight, but I think that it's the town's responsibility to supply spectator seating for all of our athletic facilities. And to my knowledge, we haven't spent any money in the last 20 years on spectator seating. In fact, the bleachers that we currently use were purchased by the Nautilus Swim Club years ago to provide spectator seating in the pool when we didn't have spectator seating. And once we did the pool renovation in 1998, those bleachers were moved outside. So I think it's a shame that right now there is nothing provided for funds for bleachers, but I truly believe we're going to have a wonderful facility, and without bleachers, it's not going to be quite as wonderful. And people will say, where's the spectator seating? And it's too bad it has been sort of linked with the turf field issue, because it's not a turf field issue. It's an issue that we need to provide spectator seating for our athletic facilities.
If I could just comment on the bleachers for a minute. I have not included it tonight because I have not received a proposal for that. My understanding was the only discussion was at a finance committee meeting a couple of weeks ago, and that's the only time it's been discussed, other than the $150,000 that was put in the bonding issue, which I'm not sure you haven't passed the bonding issue yet. So again, understanding the way I operate is I need to have a very specific plan of what's going to happen, and I haven't seen that yet.
What happened with the bleacher issue is a couple of finance committee meetings ago, Mike McGovern proposed a $150,000 bond for bleachers. We talked about it, and you know, we didn't come to any consensus. The council has felt that we needed to run that by the school board first to see if there's their support. At the subsequent finance committee meeting, we did so, and the conclusion was there wasn't any support at that time. So that got pulled from the bond issue, and that was not part of the package yesterday evening, and that will not be part of the package on the 14th of May. So that's where it is today.
Thank you, Paul.
I would actually just like to comment, because Sue, I actually think it would be phenomenal to have bleachers. I don't have any objection to having bleachers for spectators. I think that what I get back to, and Jim Rowe articulated very well, was that when the whole turf committee got together and presented what they were going to do, there were three phases. There was the turf field, there was concessions, and there were the bleachers, and that it was going to be paid for exclusively by the turf committee, which is a wonderful organization that has done many great things and has raised an incredible amount of money, and I think that's fantastic. And I think a lot of people contributed to their efforts and to the campaign, because part of the understanding was that no money would come from the town. It would come from the turf committee, which is why so many of us have supported it. And I think, once again, that's why Jim Rowe said a deal is a deal. So for myself, my saying that I would like the town not to put it in bonding doesn't have to do with my not supporting the concept of bleachers. It has more to do with limited resources in our town and what priorities we have. And when I, you know, even coming from Jeff Shedd, if I'm thinking of cutting programs in high school, you know, and then putting $150,000 towards bleachers, I think they're all great things. I'd like to do the bleachers, and I would like to do the programs, and I'd like to keep the teachers, but we can't have it all. So it puts me in a very uncomfortable position to sort of be, you know, if I say, well, I don't think the town should put bleachers in bonding, that I'm going to look like the bad guy, like I don't like the turf committee, because that's not what it's all about. It's more complex than that. So I think we need to be more honest in what we're really talking about and maybe why the school board had issue with the town coming with a bond of $150,000.
Yeah, and I didn't mean to characterize why you came to a conclusion. I'm just telling you what happened along the way. The mistake that happened, and this is in discussion with Mike McGovern, I'll just tell you what we talked about. This is the error. As Sue pointed out, the bleachers had nothing to do with the turf field, not even related. They just happened to come up at a similar time frame. Bleachers have been an issue for years. Michael, when he spoke to the council, or actually to the finance committee at the time, said that he was proposing the bleachers because he wanted bleachers there for years. And now just seemed to be an opportune time because now we have this nice new field and the turf committee and kids turf and the all the donations that had been made added up to somewhere around $800,000, almost 700 citizens. And Michael said the town should pony up and help make this facility a first-class facility. It really had nothing to do with the turf field. And how it got related, I'm not quite sure. It also had nothing to do with the school budget. If the bleachers were approved, it was totally unrelated to the school budget, completely. I mean, it's over here on the municipal side, and that money wasn't going to be transferred over to the school budget because it didn't get bonded for the municipal side.
I think of that as part of the same. Still $150,000 more to the taxpayers in our community. So just because it's not under the school budget doesn't mean it's not an additional $150,000.
I understand that. I'm just telling you how it got proposed. So somehow, when it got linked to those two other issues, that's where the confusion came in, I believe. I'm just telling you, if we had done the bleachers.
Mr. McKinney, I have to interrupt. Madam Chair, the bleachers and the concession stands have never been posted on an agenda. We are violating state law, even discussing them. It hasn't been posted for the public to know. It's time we get back to the issue at hand and just make a motion and vote on it.
I agree. We do have a motion on the floor, and we haven't heard from some people about that motion. Does anybody else wish to speak to it? Because I do, and I haven't had my chance.
Linda? I had one quick question, if I might, for Sue. There's been a schedule for activities on the turf field. Can you give us an indication of when the first games are supposed to be played on the field? Approximately. We're not going to hold you to these.
I don't think we have anything scheduled for this spring season. I believe we're looking at starting a full schedule in the fall. That's not to say that the field won't be used when it's ready, but there's no formal schedule at this point for the spring or the summer yet.
So that partially answers the question that I had, is when are we planning on using the turf field for the first time, and would fall be or summer be an indication, but not spring?
It's a matter of when the field is turned over to the town.
Okay.
But I think what you were saying is what I remember Keith saying the other night. Actual formal games, I don't think, will be until fall. That doesn't mean that the field won't be available for special games or rental games and that type of thing.
Correct.
So what I think I understood from Keith, and he's not here to confirm that one way or the other, is that the actual fall sports would be the first official sports we play on there, but there could be previous games in rental process. Does that sound familiar to you in that conversation?
That sounds right to me. They just don't know when the perimeter work will be done. There'll be a certain amount of seeding and so forth, and we don't want to take away from the progress of that kind of stuff. So when it's ready, and but right now nothing is formally planned.
That's good enough for the the answer that I was looking for, that it's not going to be next week. And my question about the lines doesn't have to do with adding additional permanent lines. It has to do with reducing some of the permanent lines that have been ordered through the change order that Michael signed that would be in turn painted versus permanent. And would that not save us money that could be used for some of the items that we set aside in our budget process, such as padding? I have asked the question, but I haven't received an answer. And I come back to the what is the hurry piece. And I know that we've talked about that the turf's being laid on Friday, but the additional tufting of the permanent lines, I'm not sure when that is going to be taking place or needs to take place. And we're not talking about playing a game here in 2 weeks. So what I come back to for myself personally is I have more questions than I have answers. Now, having said that, Alan, it's my understanding that as of this evening, I'm not sure of the time, you are now the project manager.
I have heard that, yes.
That Mr. McGovern has asked you to continue while he is away. So, for me, there's still unanswered questions, and I ask this because I'm continually taken back, and I'm concerned, and it's not about fundraising, and it's not about being very appreciative of what the town is getting, but I am worried about the Title IX implications because when you're talking about permanent versus painted lines, they are different. They might be as good, they might not be as good, but they're different. And Title IX talks about gender neutrality, and different isn't neutral, it's different. And so that bothers me. And it's not because I'm trying to belabor the point, and it's not because I'm trying to hold anything up, because I'm not. But I am concerned about that. And as a school board, I think we have to concern ourselves about those types of issues. Now, I believe you received an email today.
I do. I had an email that Michael McGovern had passed on to me today. It was from Michael Ott. I don't know if there was a question with it because it only came with a response to it. But what this says is that Doug Currier, again, somebody I do not know, spoke to a person that is considering one of the top three Title IX attorneys in the country. She is recognized by the NCAA for her expertise in the area. She told him that the lines on our field are not a Title IX violation. In fact, she laughed at the idea. We can provide her contact information if anyone would like to speak with her. And that's the only information I have, and that came from Mike McGovern today. He sent it to me at 7 this morning. So I don't know above and beyond that response if it's an issue or not. That's the best I can offer at this point, as far as that is concerned.
But that information came from Mike McGovern, who received it from Michael Ott.
It's signed by Michael Ott, and it was sent to Michael McGovern. Oh, it's sent through you too, Paul. You must have gotten it today, too. So that's what I know at this point in time.
But this was not from a town employee. This was from
a
volunteer fundraiser. Okay. So I've said what I wanted to say. Does anybody else want to add? I add to Pratt. Mary, would you read the motion again, please? Or try to. Thank you.
I thought I heard Karen say she was going to withdraw it.
Well, that's because I thought Peter was coming up with a better one over here.
Well, and then I take that back. Did you want to withdraw? Did Peter have more specific
motion? I've been trying, is all I will admit to.
Well, that's why I was asking. Do you want to withdraw your motion, Karen?
I can always reinstate it, so I will withdraw to give Peter the opportunity to present a motion that we can.
Okay. Peter.
Madam Chair, I have a motion for the board to consider. Be it resolved that based on the findings of fact and the materials presented to the board, the Cape Elizabeth School Board supports the continued development and construction of the Cape Elizabeth turf field as designed, especially with note to the layout and design of the permanent and possibility of temporary lines in the future, and that we continue to support the improvement in the communication by all interested parties in the Cape Elizabeth Turf development.
I will second.
Do you have that in writing, so Mary?
Yes, I will work with Mary after the meeting, just so that we can continue.
Sure. I just can't write that fast.
Because after my stroke, Mary, I have to tell you, I can't even read my own handwriting, so.
Okay.
I'll do my best right after the meeting.
Thank you.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there additional discussion? Peter, I am a little concerned that if there are further decisions to be made about the field, is your motion allow the school board to be involved in those decisions?
Absolutely, because after Thursday's meeting, Kathy, I'm very comfortable. I don't have to see it in writing anywhere. We've had commitments from the town council, the town manager, the superintendent, the turf committee, contractor, the engineer, that the school committee will be kept informed. So what we're bearing with tonight will never happen again, and I have confidence that that's true.
Okay. Anybody else want to add anything? Linda, you started to say something earlier, and I think you got cut off. You did not.
And I've lost it.
And you, okay. All right.
Thank you.
Okay. All in favor of the motion? Opposed? 4-1. Moving on. I think it's yours again, Alan. Consideration of request from administrator for continuation of half-time leave of absence.
See, Sarah, you didn't get forgotten. As you'll remember, I came to you last year to talk about Sarah's position as curriculum coordinator and that she is working on her doctoral dissertation. And I had said to you at the time I may be returning for a second year for her. I talked with Sarah last week, and she is making that request again. I will tell you that as we go through the agenda, I've also talked to the people who have stepped in for her in the process, and I have those as well. But what I would do is read, no, I don't need to read the letter. You have it in front of you. But what she is talking about is that she truly needs the 2007-2008 school year, the 105 days to complete her doctoral dissertation for Lesley College. And she says here, which I think is an important point, I believe that the job sharing arrangement has been made between Shari Robinson and myself, and between Shari and Christine Bolsa O'Meara have worked well this year, have enhanced our program at a variety of levels. Both Shari and Chris are excited about the opportunity to continue their work next year. What I have brought to you is recommending that we give Sarah that second year, which is a half year paid at half salary, to complete her doctorate, and she will also be very much involved, particularly in the curriculum development here in the system.
Is there a motion? We have to vote on it, correct? Yes.
I move that we accept superintendent's recommendation to approve a half-time status, part-time status for one more year. Sarah Simmons.
Is there a second?
I second.
Karen, thanks. Discussion.
Just a quick clarification, this doesn't cost us anything.
Cost us above and beyond?
I mean, yeah, over and above these positions. There's no incremental cost. So I support it in concept, just wanted to clarify that. That's what I thought. Thank you.
Other comments, questions? All in favor? 5-0. Consideration of superintendent's recommendation to continue current split job assignment of Shari Robinson.
I didn't realize that came up quite so quickly.
Sorry.
First of all, Shari and I had talked, but today she did bring me a letter feeling she probably ought to put something on file with that record, so I do have her letter here. But basically what she's saying to me is that I would be thrilled to continue the arrangement of job sharing with Sarah Simmons in the professional development position and with Chris Bolsa O'Meara in the media center. I'll summarize the rest as this. She has seeing that this request and this process this year has really proved very valuable, both to her and her learning process, and also to the curriculum director process. I have been extremely impressed with the opportunity to have somebody step in who could take over that role, and so that Sarah could feel comfortable in doing what she needs to do, and have somebody who comes in and moves on from there. And I would say to particularly those of you who serve on the Future Directions Committee, I have met with each of these people and talked about their work, and it is amazing to me how well the work that both Sarah and Shari is doing comes together to meet the goals of our future direction project. And so I highly recommend that we continue with Shari in that position as a halftime position. What she has done this year is she works at On Cove in the library in the morning, and then she does the other half of that job as part of the curriculum process in the afternoon. So going along with that, I also have the letter from Christine Bolsa O'Meara, who has stepped into the library in the afternoon when Shari is not there. She's worked very closely with Shari to plan so that there seems to be little dysfunction as far as the change process in the library, and Christine has done a great job. And so I would also recommend that we look at Christine to continue on as a halftime librarian. She is certified as a librarian. I should mention also that she would continue on as the librarian. So I would need a motion from you about Shari, and then a motion for you about Christine O'Meara. Also.
Thank you, Alan. Somebody want to make a motion?
Did you make a recommendation? Can I make my motion on that? Mm-hmm. I make a motion that we support the superintendent's recommendation for the job sharing arrangement with Chris, also O'Meara, and Shari Robinson.
Thank you. Second?
Second.
Linda? Thanks. Any discussion? No? All in favor? 5-0. Okay. Trish, consideration of policies for first reading.
I'm going to go through them quickly. We're not voting, but I would gladly accept any comments. Advertising, KHB. We did discuss this one at length. There are some changes. Does anyone have any questions or comments? And if you don't now, we're meeting on May 15th, and we'd be happy to have you forward them to me so we can discuss them at that
time. Excuse me. And thank you for having this stuff in red so that we can see what the changes are. It makes it so much easier.
Assignment of students to classes is 5-year-olds. The changes that were made were suggested by Drummond and Woodson to comply with exceptions in the law. So it's driven by legal legalities. One thing, Mary, that I noticed when I went back and looked at the Drummond and Woodson comment, apparently the legal reference has changed. So the .2 after section 5201.2, the .2 should be removed. It's just 5201. Next policy, JJIA, which is the Athletic Steering Committee. We're recommending deleting because the Athletic Steering Committee no longer exists.
I had a question about it no longer exists, but is there a need for it, and are we saying that there's not a need for it, and that's why we're deleting?
It falls under all of those responsibilities fall into the extracurricular committee.
Okay.
We've sort of grouped them all, so that was why. JJJ-R1, the athletic substance abuse policy, we're recommending deletion of this because it's been incorporated into the new substance abuse policy we approved last year, which is policy JICH. I think that's it for first reading.
Thank you, Trish. Consideration of job description from Personnel Committee. Linda?
The Personnel Committee last month, now that Ellen is back with us and able to attend meetings on a regular basis, we tackled the teacher job description. It has been reviewed by members of the teachers' negotiations as well as Ellen. I'd like to make a motion to accept the new job description as presented.
Is there a second? Trish, any discussion?
I just had a quick question.
Sure.
Under the education and certification, do we need to, I mean, I know the whole fingerprinting and all that stuff, do we need to have anything in there that says they're comply with any law?
Legal? Just says other legal credentials required.
Okay, so that sort of covers it. Thank you.
And my question was just about provisional certification. Does this allow for teachers who might have a provisional status?
I defer that to Alan.
It would allow a teacher with provisional status as long as they fit the HQT requirements within the school system.
Other questions?
Conditional certification doesn't need to.
Okay, so that answers the question.
Other questions? All in favor? Opposed? 5-0. Consideration of superintendent's nominations of teachers for continuing contract?
I need to borrow your sheet in the mask of all his papers while it's here somewhere, but I can't find it. Okay, teachers eligible for continuing contract status. As a reminder, these are people who have been probationary teachers, and they have finished their second year. I have gone back to the principals to confirm whether these people should be renominated and therefore go to continuing contract. So what you have is Fawn Cove, you have Nicole Ball, who is a kindergarten teacher, Tara Bucci, who is a grade 2 teacher, Morgan Burns, who is a special education teacher, Lisa Derman, who's a grade 2 teacher, and Mary Ann Harrington, who is a grade 2 teacher. You also have for middle school, Marguerite Lawler Roner, who is the art teacher. You have Susan Quirk, who is at grade 6, and Holly Smivog, who is technology integrator halftime. At the high school, you have Allison Weather, who is Spanish, Lisa Melanson, who is English Achievement Center, and Robert Thompson, who is Instructional Support and Achievement Center. One person who's missing off here that I just want to comment on quickly is that we have a person who is doing health at Fawn Cove at this point, Gina Rossi, who has been with us for 2 years. She's a probationary teacher. She's an excellent teacher. She receives only the highest of recommendations. However, you remember through the budget process that we had several positions on that we needed to deal with. One was nursing, and one was the position of health. The year before last, Scott was doing both middle school and elementary health. When the full-time position came back to the middle school, we lost that half of Scott. So what has happened is I need to move him back to middle school and elementary school, and therefore have to take Gina's position away at that point in time. She is the lowest person on the scale. I don't like to do it, but as you know, we had some very hard decisions to make through the budget process. And that was one of the things that did not get funded, along with a few other positions like the nurse, et cetera. And so Gina is not on this list, even though we would love to have her there because of the lack of funding. So what I am presenting to you are the people who are on the list because their positions are available, and that we will rehire them as continuing contract teachers.
Okay. Would you like somebody like to make a motion?
Oh, we can discuss after
that. Right.
I move that we approve the teachers as presented for continuing contract status.
Is there a second?
Second.
Linda? Conversation?
I would just like to comment that in light of the work that we hope to be doing with the Wellness Committee, that we reconsider bringing back a health position to help us with the work that hopefully we will want to move forward.
And if I can just add to confirm what I think you're saying is, at this point in time, I do not have that money in the budget. Mm-hmm. If you wanted to do it for 07-08, I will have to cut something in order to make something, so that we understand, because I already have a $44,000 cut I've got to make. So if you're looking at it for 08-09, then we could return to that issue. But if you're looking for it at 07-08, it would require a cut in order to put that position back in.
And I guess I would just defer to you on where you felt that fit in the priorities.
From my perspective, I serve on the Wellness Committee with you, and you know, I highly value the work that we can do in health. I feel we're doing only marginal work in health. So I would love to see that there, but I have not even looked at what I might cut out of the school department in order to make that happen. I have talked with principals. I've gotten some suggestions for the $44,000 in cuts I've got to do. As much as I prize that position, and as much as there are other positions I would prize also, my dilemma comes in the fact of what I do keep and what I don't keep for programs. You've added some programs. You remember you added the halftime math assistant at the Pond Cove, and therefore we didn't do some other positions. So what I would have to do, if there was a feeling from the board that you want me to go back to that issue, then I would have to go back to the principals and administrators to talk about what could we cut that would make that happen. And I would say to you, it would be, from my perspective anyway, it would be a person and a position that we would have to cut to do that for 07-08.
I'd just like to reiterate, and again, I'll leave it to you whether it's this year or next year, but hearing very positive feedback on that alcohol presentation at the high school last night from kids, they were startled by some of the discussions at the end, but interestingly enough, they commented that some of the facts they knew because of the health classes they have had. So just an editorial comment, we're being penny wise and pound foolish, because we're going to have to keep having those alcohol programs, and unfortunately probably dealing with tragedy if we can't intervene at an earlier age.
No, you're exactly on target.
Allowing me to vent a little bit.
No, you're exactly on target.
Anybody else? No. I forgot what we were doing.
We seconded the motion. Thank you. We didn't vote yet. We need to vote.
All in favor? Opposed? 5-0. Okay. Consideration of superintendent's nominations of teacher to second year probationary contract.
Again, remember that when we hire a teacher, they are 2 years probationary. These people are people who are on probation for their first year in Cape Elizabeth this year. Again, have been evaluated by their administrators. I've had discussions on each of them, and we are looking at these people as people we would rehire for a second year. I will only add here, and I want to be very, very clear, because I've said this to you before. When I look at when these people move to continuing contract, I have a $1 million clause. Are these people worth $1 million that you could easily invest in them in the years they might stay here? And so I'm willing to look at the first year and look at the possibilities, but the second year I really push hard and say, you tell me, are we making the right decision? So with that in mind, I have Pond Cove School, I have Roberta Shecker, who is a social worker at halftime. I have Christine Bolsa O'Meara, who you just voted on, would be a librarian halftime for 1 year, and that's a 1 year position again. You have Angela Brown, who is an instructional support, this would be her second year. At middle school, you have Adam Killip, who is a grade 5, Pierre Parody, who is grade, I think he's grade combination 7 and 8, and you have Christina Moniz, who is grade 5. At the high school, you have Erin Cavallero, who will be teaching English, Sharon Dorsey, who is chemistry, Christine Newell, who is math, and Tom Shahey is a 0.5 for English. I'm going to go back to Jeff for just 1 minute on Erin Cavallero. She has been on duty this year, and you evaluate her this year?
Yes.
So she should really be going to a second year probationary. Oh, that's what she's going to. That's right. Okay. There's been so much discussion here, I'm losing track of where we are. So that's where she would be.
Thank you. Is there a motion?
I move we accept the superintendent's recommendation for second year probationary contracts as presented.
Thank you. Is there a second? Trish, discussion? No? All in favor? 5-0. Thank you. Committee reports? No. Consideration of superintendent's nomination to teaching positions for 07-08.
You've already done both of those. There are Erin Cavallero, who we're looking for at the high school, and Christine Bolsa O'Meara, who you have done also. So you have done both of those positions within the process I just took.
Okay. Thank you. You were just giving me my papers back. Sorry, lost my place. Committee reports. Rebecca's not here, there was no finance committee last month, is that right?
Right.
Okay, we don't have to worry about that report. Policy committee, Trish?
In addition to the policies presented for first and second reading tonight, we also spent a great deal of time discussing the truancy and attendance policy, and we did not come to any conclusions. Some of the policies, we're going to continue to go through the J section, which will be dealing with policies on placement. Also, since calendar committee is a subcommittee of the policy committee, and it's not separately reported, I would like to report that the calendar committee met on April 23rd to dream. We talked about what an ideal school calendar would look like and had a universal agreement that more instructional time, either as additional days or longer days, would be nice. We realized that there were contractual and cost implications, and we felt some of these ideas and challenges might be incorporated into the work being done by the strategic planning committee. So we turned our discussions over to them, realizing that the calendar committee might be called upon to be an action team to further investigate possibilities.
Thank you, Trish. Communication?
The View is in people's mailboxes, and as I said, will be delivered, and that was really where we spent our time, a lot of time. And we're meeting next Monday, the 14th, to kind of wrap up the year and sort of see where, what we did well, what we need to improve on.
Thank you, Trish. Personnel, Linda?
Personnel committee met on April 19th in the Jordan Conference Room. First time we discussed was the contract negotiations for the different groups that we have coming up very soon. In the minutes, I provided a breakdown of the different groups, the contracts, and the board members that will be serving on those negotiating teams. We went through the teacher job description, as we voted on earlier, and evaluation forms. Next item we discussed was the superintendent's evaluation, and we tried to get a little more specific as far as the time frame for both our written evaluation and the salary contractual evaluation. Our next meeting is scheduled for May 16th in the Jordan Conference Room.
Thank you. Strategic planning, Trish?
The committee met to hear the discussion and to discuss feedback from the principals on the draft goals and objective statement. We made some changes as a result of these discussions and want to thank the principals for their input. The document will next make its way to the teachers for their consideration and feedback, and we're working towards a draft document to be presented to the school board at the May workshop with hopes that the school board will then take a vote in June and we can sort of get up and running for next school year.
Thank you, Trish. Student Extracurricular Committee, Linda.
The extracurricular committee met on May 1st. Alan provided just a brief update on the status of the turf field for us at that time, as far as where they were at. And at that point in time, we were also aware of our gathering with the town council and members of the turf committee that following Thursday evening. The committee continued to review several policies, which we have all recommended be forwarded on to the policy committee, which will have quite a large agenda for this month. And a lot of these policies deal specifically with areas concerning the turf field as far as admissions and gate receipts. And we also went into the evaluation of coaches and also the philosophy and beliefs. We've been trying to strive this year to get through as many of the policies for updates and revisions as we can. And I would like to take the opportunity to thank Keith, Sue, Jeff, as well as other members of the town, such as Bob Malley, Chief Williams, because they've had a great deal of input as we've been trying to go through and make revisions to our policies, especially those that have relevance to the turf field. We've needed their input as far as traffic management, security, and other issues as we've been dealing with them. Hopefully the documents that we will be providing for the school board's approval will actually enhance the use of the facility that we'll be looking at here in the next few months.
Thank you, Linda.
Thanks.
Does anybody want to report on the Wellness Committee?
I can make a brief report.
Thank you, Karen.
Peter, if you want to add anything, please do, because I know you were there as well. But yesterday we met as a wellness committee and Dr. Victoria Rogers came to speak to us about Let's Go, a 5210 health nutrition initiative. She spoke to us for probably 45 minutes and it's a program that we might want to consider adopting and customizing to meet the needs of the Cape schools and the Cape community. But we will be meeting again the first Monday of June to determine as a wellness committee how we want to proceed.
Thank you, Karen. Technology, Linda.
Well, actually, I wasn't able to attend last month's technology committee meeting, but I did speak briefly with Gary, and he let me know that they got through just the most of the last three points of the new technology plan. A working draft of the plan out on the school website. We are looking to have the plan submitted to the department by the end of this month.
Great, thank you. Moving to public comment. I don't see any. Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize.
That's okay.
I looked up.
It's the hour of the night.
Yes.
I'll be fast. Hi. As most of you know, last night I presented what the association has labeled a call for renewal of our commitment to the tradition of excellence in Cape Elizabeth schools. And the association asked, out of respect for the school board and appreciation for the work that you have done over the past few difficult years, that I actually present the official version to you, both out, as I said, of your recognition for the work you've done, appreciation for that, and because we recognize that if we are to be successful in our communication to the public, it's basically going to be a responsibility of a collaborative effort, school board, administration, teachers, and of course, parents. I won't take the time to repeat the presentation I made last evening. Clearly, we do have some concerns. We think we've lost momentum over the last few years. We just want you to know that we very much look forward to working with you in a collaborative effort to bring this message to a community that has always been most supportive of our schools. Thank you.
I think most of us were there last night, so I think we heard your longer version. Thank you very much.
Is that a copy of it?
Yes.
Oh, that's great. Thanks.
Thank you for taking the time to do that, to prepare it and to present it. It was very well done.
Any other public comment? I'll look up a little longer. Yes?
As a public comment, if I can remain seated here, I appreciate it. I would just like to thank all the citizens that did come out last night to speak, including Trish, to speak on behalf of the school board, and the request that the town council seriously consider the increase in the school budget of at least 3%, possibly even 3.24%. And I just wanted to thank all those individuals that came out and spoke to that effect last night.
Thank you, Linda. Anybody else? No? School board agenda requests. Does anybody have any?
I don't have an agenda request, but I have something about tonight's meeting, and I just have to do this for clarification.
Yes.
With the motion that you voted on as far as the turf field is concerned, did that motion also include the concession stand, or did it not?
Did not.
It did not. And so I just am checking on that to find out where the board wants to go. And I'm sorry, I missed it at the time. I didn't even think of it. But I did have it as a part of my suggestion. And, you know, you can go without doing anything about it, or else decide to, again, give permission for them to proceed with that as well.
Okay. Does anybody want to say anything with reference to Alan's question?
Just a clarification point. We were put on the spot for the lines by the town council and the kids' turf because of the time. The concession is phase two. If we're re-energizing the group, the committee, do we need to do this now, or would this be then put on the plates of the committee to come to us with recommendations?
I can only speak from the perspective I have, and I was asked to meet with Jim McFarland by the town manager to find out what was going on. I met with Jim on Monday morning, early Monday morning, and he took me through the process that his subgroup of the Kids Turf Committee was working on. And so I presented to you in that proposal the things that they have worked on so far, which basically included a 30 by 40 foot turf building. It was to be used one-third, one-third, one-third for food, storage, and for bathrooms. They have done some research with Black Point Inn about bathroom facilities and also about kitchen possibilities. I think from the perspective of the work that they have been doing, which they are seeing is not costing the town any money, is that they just need to have the go-ahead to continue to do their research. And I did say in there very clearly, any changes they look at, whether it's a change in size, either larger or smaller, if they do get kitchen equipment, they have to go to the fire department, they have to go to the planning board and those things. So what I really was presenting to you is what I have at this point in time from them, based on what they have been doing at this point in time. I think what they need to have, and again, I'm only doing this from the conversation I had Monday morning and also a conversation I had with Mike McGovern, is that I think what they're looking for is, are we safe in proceeding ahead with the things that we need based on what I put in that document, which I sent to Jim to take a look at, and that if there are any changes, et cetera, there will be clear communication back to the board and to the town council about what those are. I should also say to you that I put a copy of that in Paul's email. I do not normally, as a superintendent, send direct email to all town council members any more than Michael normally does not send to you. So I told Paul that he could pass that along. But to make a long story short, what I'm looking for is to be able to say to Jim, as in his role in that subcommittee, that there is enough feeling that he should go ahead and continue the work and the research that he's doing.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I appreciate the fact that the Turf Committee is communicating with the superintendent's office by email, but I don't think they formally presented any package that we can even consider discussion, because to be presented an idea of a concession stand saying it might be 30 by 20, it might be 30 by 40, it might be 30 by 60. But again, I appreciate the fact that the lines of communication are much more open than they have been. But perhaps they should even present it at workshop, much like we do with other general ideas we have for discussion, and just give us their ideas and perhaps ask for our input. Nothing binding, but nothing has been presented to the board in a formal application asking our approval, because we haven't seen a decent drawing of it, our true cost figure. But again, I do appreciate the fact that they're communicating very early and on a daily basis with the office of the superintendent, and I hope that continues. And I encourage them to continue developing the turf field and just keeping the lines of communication open.
No, I'm just taking a breath.
Well, I'm thinking, I personally support it, but I'm struggling sort of with Peter's comments and sort of practicing what we preach. If we've asked for this committee to lead the charge, so to speak, and it has town council representatives, it has school board, the more I think about it, then it really should be that committee that makes a recommendation to the school board and the town council for their approval.
I hear what you're saying.
I mean, I personally, if you're not looking for a vote.
I don't consider we have a yes or no vote on it, but if the committee comes up with a formal proposal, then we can simply say we're in support of it.
I guess that's...
I can't be asked if I'm in support of a building and I don't know the outside dimensions of it. I'm just very uncomfortable saying proceed, even.
I'm in complete agreement with what I'm hearing Trish say and what I'm hearing Peter say and what I've heard Marianne Lynch say and several of the town councils say, that we would like to get the process up and running with that committee. It seemed to fall apart. We'd like to get it back together and proceed through that channel. And if the information comes to us through that channel, which I feel agree is an appropriate channel and a great way to keep the lines of communication open, then we would be comfortable making decisions on these things.
For example, if the committee could have come before the board, and I again suggest at workshop, and showed us a complete layout of the lines, and simply asked, do we have your support? We would have been home at 8:30 tonight. And there wouldn't have been the animosity that we have.
So that's probably not what...
What I need from you is to give me some direction with that. You know, I'm following what I was asked to do. I had the meeting. I sent to you what I had. I understand very clearly what Peter is saying. And, you know, I think we need to have those steps in the process. But I also feel very strongly that I had to present to you that I felt he had a good argument. He has done some serious research. And so if we need to take that next step, then I think it returns back to Paul and to Kathy, because they will be reformulating that committee. and to get things going from there.
So if I'm understanding, there is not a motion at this point from the board.
Correct.
Trish, did you want to say something?
I'm just very conflicted. I support it, and I don't want to hold up the process, but I'm a little concerned about the process.
Well, I think you're hearing others echo that same concern.
Is it possible, Kathy and Alan, to have it on the next workshop meeting of the school board so that we can...
I'm hesitating, okay. But I think if we can take a look at it, I have a fairly full agenda for the 22nd. But on the other side of the coin, if it's something we need to do to move things ahead, then I would do some arranging to make that happen.
I believe this is important enough as one member. I'm making myself eligible to attend one more meeting.
I think the only question is, if you want information back from that original turf committee, yep. That turf committee has got to be reinstituted because we have some people who've left office, and the decision of whether they continue on as citizens or how that plays out. So I don't even know, you know, I have to depend on Paul and Kathy as far as how we're going to make that happen. So.
And our membership from before was Kevin and Ann Belden. So if the school board is to have two members, then I just want to have you folks keep it in mind, because at least one additional member will be needed if Kevin wishes to continue on in his role. So, and if he doesn't, then we'll need two members. So just give some thought to as to whether you want to be that person.
And I would toss out, I mean, the workshop is another being sensitive to the agenda. If we have the information, why could it not go the way the light proposal went in the turf field itself, and that we got the information beforehand, we had the recommendation of that committee, and then we would take a vote at our June business meeting. That allows a month's period of time for that committee to meet, to come up with a recommendation, do the legwork, and then do the presentation. We could have the information beforehand, and then we take a vote in June.
I think We will do whatever we need to do to make that
one happen. Member, I don't want to delay anything at all.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. That's yeah.
Don't ask me to vote on something I can't picture in my own mind.
Okay. Announcement of upcoming meetings. Strategic planning. I'm sorry, Trish, you said it was.
I don't have my calendar. I'm sorry. I think it's May 29th. Tuesday, May 29th at 12:30. You help me out, Mary, I think. I'm scheduling that in Alan's office. I'm not holding you to it. I will get back to you. It's at the end of May.
It is Tuesday, and I think it's 29th.
I believe so. I will confirm that.
And the Communication Committee is meeting Monday, May 14th at 3 p.m. Pond Cove Media Center. Policy Committee is Tuesday, May 15th at 12 noon, Jordan Conference Room. Finance Committee, Wednesday, May 23rd at 8:30 a.m. in the Superintendent's office. School Board Business Meeting is Tuesday, June 12th at 7 p.m. Council Chambers. Do we know when the next Wellness Committee is, Karen?
It's the first Monday in June.
First Monday in June.
Is it the 4th?
June 4th. At 3:15 at the fire station. Does that sound right?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Personnel is Wednesday, May 16th at 8 a.m. in Jordan Conference Room. School Board Workshop, Tuesday, May 22nd, 7 p.m., High School Library. Topics, update on strategic plan, budget planning for 2007-08. And the Student Extracurricular Committee is Tuesday, June 5th, 3 to 4 p.m. in the Jordan Conference Room. Have I left anything out?
I move to adjourn Tuesday. Yes. It is. Okay. Because it's the 22nd, it's Tuesday, 29th, is Tuesday.
Okay. Thank you, Mary. Is there a second? There's 3 or 4 seconds, okay. Any discussion? All in favor? 5-0. Thank you very much.